Hi, my name is Nick Vitsas. I am a PhD student at the Computer Graphics Group of the Athens University of Economics and Business. This is a presentation of our work on sampling clear sky models using truncated Gaussian mixtures. In outdoor or open environments, lighting from the sky dome is one of the most important contributors to a scene's appearance. Actually, simulating all the contributing complex atmospheric scattering effects is a significantly involved and computationally expensive procedure. Researchers have proposed methods to encode the rich appearance of the sky into simple, analytic formulas that can be evaluated efficiently and provide a good approximation to the actual appearance of the sky. These are regularly referred to as analytic sky models, and two of the most well-known are the Pritham and Hose clear sky models. Their usefulness comes from the fact that they can rapidly and efficiently generate plausible sky maps and are of particular interest to real-time applications like video games that support time-of-day input and offline production rendering, as well as architectural applications that require environment lighting simulations. Although so much work has taken place on efficient simulation of the radiance distribution of the sky, not much effort has been put to the efficient sampling of such distributions. Sampling such models naturally falls under the general topic of environment map sampling, which has been studied extensively. A robust sampling approach is to use a probability density function generated from a radiance-based map by defining a piecewise constant 2D probability density function in image coordinates. Other, more compact and approximate approaches have also been proposed over the years, such as using hard wavelet or spherical harmonics representations, which have been shown to be applicable in the context of important sampling. Previous research in environment sampling has also led to hierarchical subdivisions for sampling like Penrose and Voronoi tiling, stratified sampling of regions, and approximate cascading sets of conditional and marginal one-dimensional CDFs. These are generic solutions that would definitely work for sky sampling, but one could take advantage of clear sky appearance properties, and as we will show with truncated Gaussian mixture models, one can push the overhead bar very low while maintaining accuracy and performance. We want a PDF that is a good approximation of the sky's distribution. We want to be able to sample from it efficiently and without using any form of rejection sampling. Same goes with evaluating it. We want to keep memory usage at a minimum, and finally, we want to stay independent of the parameterization of a particular sky model so that it can be applied to any other clear sky representation. We will show how this can be achieved using a low component mixture model of truncated Gaussians. First of all, in order to get an initial understanding of what we are trying to achieve, the process we are aiming for is shown here. We start from the radiance map generated by a clear sky model and generate a luminance-based distribution map that effectively encodes the importance of each pixel. Then, this reference distribution is fitted using a low component mixture model. This mixture model uses truncated Gaussian components to allow for accurate fitting and exact sampling within the sky's domain. Finally, the mixture model is used to sample the sky. This sampling process can be easily integrated into any important sampling scheme. Mixture models are learned probabilistic models, so we need to train them on data. So, what data should we train on? Our TGMM, and therefore our fitting process, is performed on the 2D domain. There are many ways to map the spherical domain to 2D. It facilitates our fitting process to work on the latitude-longitude parameterization. A luminance-based distribution map can easily be generated from the radiance map of the underlying model. If we plot this luminance-based distribution of the sky, we get this surface. We already get the sense that this can be fitted by a combination of Gaussian terms, but we have these abrupt truncations at the horizon that we will handle using truncated Gaussians to avoid any need for rejection sampling. Since we are doing our fitting process offline, we are able to approach the problem with any optimization method. We took a surface fitting approach, where the goal is to construct a surface defined by a TGMM that as closely as possible matches the initial radiance distribution data. Overfitting is desirable here. We considered several loss functions, including some that have been used specifically for PDF fitting. but we got the best result using the mean absolute error measure. We start with the luminance-based distribution of data, which is our target surface. We use least squares fitting to perform surface fitting of a regular GMM on the data. The Gaussian components are optimized on their variance and mean together with the weight of each component. Normal Gaussians extend to infinity, and so does the surface we have created. We need to truncate it. However, simply truncating each individual component within this range distorts the PDF. So we need to refit the weight. In order to get back to a surface that closely matches the initial data, now using truncated components, we perform yet another least squares fitting, but this time we only optimize on the weights of the picture model, leaving the variance and mean of each component as is. The resulting model is a valid PDF that closely approximates the initial distribution and consists of truncated Gaussian components. Here are the results of the fitting process. On the left, the surface defined by the luminance distribution, and on the right, the fitted surface using a 5-component truncated Gaussian mixture model. For clear sky models, we experimentally found that a 5-component mixture model can offer great approximation across the parameter range of a particular sky model. We tested our fitting process with 5 Gaussians on both the Hosek and Pritham sky models, which are very commonly used. When reconstructed in 2D, the approximation error on both remains very low. These are the results of the fitting process on a specific instance of the sky. Sampling from mixture models is fairly straightforward. We first sample from the categorical distribution constructed by the weights of each component, and then sample from that component independently. We also add the constraint that the fitted Gaussian components have a diagonal covariance matrix. This allows us to sample the x and y variables independently from one-dimensional truncated Gaussians. This is important as it enables exact sampling within the truncation region of the 2D image domain. Regularly, this approach can be used for Gaussians with non-diagonal covariance matrices, as we can simply rotate it so that the two 1D components become independent again. However, in cases with truncation bounds, this rotation of the Gaussian would also rotate the bounds, leaving a sampling region that is hard to sample without rejection. It might not be so clear in this case, but consider a Gaussian that is very close to the truncation bounds. It is very difficult to sample this region without rejection. Thankfully, in our case, we do not need to be concerned, as axially aligned Gaussians suffice for clear sky models, and can handle these types of truncation regions because there is no transformation involved. The TGMMs are in practice weighted linear combinations of regular such Gaussians. Even with few components, they are able to model complex distributions. Moving to the experiments, let's first see what's our reference. We discussed earlier that the most generic approach is to consider a piecewise constant 2D distribution. Here's a quick overview of how it works. We firstly calculate the conditional and marginal distribution of the environment map from an equal or lower resolution luminance-based map. Using summed area tables, we use the marginal 1D distribution to sample a row, and then the 1D conditional distribution of that row to sample a pixel. This approach is robust and generic and can be applied to any environment map. However, it can be costly for the case of sampling sky models. It has large memory requirements for even a single instance of the sky. The tabular data for both the PDF and CDF need to be present for correct sampling. It requires 2 log n search operations for each sample, one over the marginal CDF and one over the conditional CDF of the selected row. A TGMM, on the other hand, is very compact and dispenses with the binary search and can help immensely in our case of sampling clear sky models. First of all, let's see the results in a standard outdoor open environment. Based on both root mean squared error and mean absolute error measures, we see that sampling using our method manages to stay very close to a SAT-based approach even with a few samples. In a second environment, we have an enclosed space where the bright part of the sky is only visible through the window. The shown pictures are rendered using light sampling only and no form of visibility sampling. Again, sampling with our method enables accurately generating samples according to the true luminance distribution of the sky and remains very close to the SAT-based approach. Even in an example with complex subsurface phenomena, we can see that our approach stays competitive with the more expensive SAT approach. A modern rendering framework has a lot of heavy components apart from sampling, so we considered that the most accurate benchmark would be to measure sample throughput. In addition to the low memory overhead, these tables show that both on the CPU and the GPU, sampling using a TGMM outperforms the SAT-based implementation consistently. After seeing the benchmarks, an interesting question is where is the cross point? Where does our sampling become better than the SAT approach? If we need a lot more samples to get better results than the SAT, then this might not be worth it. Performing an equal quality experiment, we saw that despite requiring 1 to 2 extra samples, we obtained a 30% speedup. Concluding, we presented a fast and compact representation of the sky luminance PDF for clear sky models. The parameterization is not tied to any particular model and is therefore easy to reuse or retrain the model for different clear sky models. It is very easy to include into any existing important sampling framework. We provide source code implementation for both the fitting process and the actual sampling and evaluation of the resulting TGMMs in Python. We also provide a reference implementation of our method as a PBRT version 3 plugin. Finally, we provide pre-trained models for the HOSEC and PrythonSky models as part of the supplemental material. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Nick, for the great presentation. And any questions from the audience?
Hello.
Hi. So I have one question first. So is it possible to use this model for general spherical functions like the indoor emergent map or for incoming radius distribution? Is it possible?
Well, the GMMs are generally models that can fit to any data you provide. But in this particular case that we wanted a low component GMM, we take advantage of the particular parameterization of the sky that we use, the latitude longitude parameterization, which allows us to use very few Gaussians, 5 in particular.
Okay, I see. Then I have the second question. Mm-hmm. So imagine they have the sky changes over time. And for each sky map, we are using several Gaussians to fit it. How to keep the temporal coherence between these different sky maps? Is it an issue?
We actually tested that, and we have some reference to it in the paper. We simply use a discrete sampling, so we simply go to the next Gaussian, and we show that there is no problem when it comes to variance. So if you have 45 degrees, for example, and using the Gaussian that has been trained on 46 degrees, it's not a particular problem. The variance that is introduced is minimal to non-existent. So it's not really a problem to use a piecewise constant approach when you need to interpolate.
Okay, that's great. And I have another question is, could you please talk about how to push this method further for real-time rendering?
Actually, real-time rendering was a major concern in our case, and that's why we tried to keep the Gaussian components very low. Mm-hmm. And that's why we have micro benchmarks also in the paper. So it's ready for real-time rendering. A question is if we can apply it to other sky models, and this is the reason why have the source code open so that other researchers can try and fit the Gaussians to other sky models. But yeah, it's ready for real time rendering
right now.
Yeah.
We are looking forward to it. Okay, so we get a question. That's great.
Hi.
Hi, Nick. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
So I was wondering, maybe I missed something. What's the main advantage of truncated versus just a regular GMM? Because it looks like you can still take the bounds and, you know, you can just subtract the value of the CDF at the corners.
Yes. It's a fact about how we use the fitting process to fit the regular GMM, and the weights we get are not ready for the are not representative of the importance of its lobe within the truncation bounds. So to put it more precisely, the PDF under the curve is not one, so we don't know the importance, the correct importance of its lobe. So we convert them to truncated, so that you have a PDF that is that integrates one, and we have correct importance when it comes to sampling its lobe.
But can you not just get that by subtracting the values at the corners of the domain?
It's you can do it, but the weights of the GMM that we initially get are not representative of the importance of its lobe within the truncation region.
Okay. I haven't read your paper. Thanks.
Yes, thank you.
So I think we are approaching the end of the question. And thanks, Nick, again for the great presentation.
Thank you, too.
Thank you. So the next paper is important sampling of glittering BSDFs based on finite mixture distribution by Xavier Sherman, Basile Sauvage, Jean-Michel Dichler, and Carsten Dachsbach. Xavier is going to give the presentation.
I will share my screen. Okay. So I'm Xavier. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at the University of Strasbourg. I'm going to present our work entitled Important Sampling of Glittering BSDF Based on Finite Mixture Distributions. This project was realized with Basile Sauvage and Jean-Michel Dichler from the University of Strasbourg and with Carsten Darsbacher from the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology. I will introduce our topic. Our work is about important sampling of BSDF. BSDF model light reflection and transmission at surface interface. Different BSDF leads to different appearances. For example, here you can see the slice of a glossy BSDF modeling rough metal or glass. Importance sampling of BSDF is an efficient variance reduction technique used by Monte Carlo renderers for an incident direction, outgoing light directions are sampled according to the scattering distribution. Here you can see two equal time renderings with important sampling activating on the left, leading to less variance in the image. Our work is about important sampling of a glittering BSDF. Glittering BSDF have a multi-lobe component and are more challenging to sample compared to glossy BSDF. Glittering BSDF typically model the appearance of glittering surfaces such as ice, snow, glitter, and sand. We focus on important sampling of analytic glittering BSDF. Analytic BSDF have a low memory footprint and spatially varying parameters. For example, analytic glossy BSDF have a spatially varying roughness parameter. Analytic glittering BSDF have a spatially varying roughness and microfacet density parameter. Note that glittering BSDF with two parameters cover a broader range of materials than glossy BSDF. In fact, a glossy BSDF is a glittering BSDF with a microfacet density equals to infinity. Now I will talk about related work. Jacob and colleagues have introduced a glittering BSDF with a microfacet density parameter in 2014. Since several models were developed with their pros and cons, as said in the introduction, we focus on BSDF with partially varying parameters, and only the last two methods propose this property in their implementation. However, the glittering BSDF of Zer and Kaplan is not physically based, but the BSDF of Sherman and colleagues is. So we build upon the glittering BSDF of Sherman and colleagues, and in our paper, we provide an important sampling procedure for this BSDF. Note that in all methods, the important sampling is based on the monolob approximation. I will now explain what the monolob approximation is. When we sample a glittering BSDF, we have to sample its multi-lob component. As I just said, a current glittering BSDF sample a monolob approximation of the BSDF for simplicity. This approach fits a kind of mean behavior but misses the sharp lobes. Our work demonstrates that this technique is not efficient and leads to a poor convergence rate. Almost all glittering BSDF are based on the microfacet theory. In this theory, all the geometry inside the pixel or wave footprint is called the microsurface. The microsurface consists of perfectly specular microfacets with normals following a pixel normal distribution function, abbreviated PNDF. In order to evaluate the BSDF, the normal distribution is converted into a scattering distribution. The PNDF can be represented in the projected space of normals and also in the slope space. In the last case, we have a pixel slope distribution function, abbreviated PSDF. Now I will explain how Sherman and colleagues procedurally compute a multi-lob PSDF coherent with respect to surface position and level of detail. A glittering surface is seen through a pixel. The pixel footprint size allows access to two adjacent levels of details of a virtual MIP hierarchy where the surface is partitioned into cells. The cell coordinate allows to randomly select two 1D SDFs contained in a set of precomputed SDFs. The tensor product of these two distributions gives the 2D SDF of the cell. The transformation M is applied to this distribution, which randomizes the lob orientations and controls the material's roughness. This operation is applied to each cell, and the resulting transformed SDFs are averaged, which gives the PSDF at the current LOD. The same process is applied to the lower LOD, and interpolation between the two PSDF at adjacent LODs gives the slope distribution in the pixel footprint P. I will now present our work, that is our sampling procedure of the PSDF of Sherman and colleagues. We first sample LOD according to the fractional part of the continuous LOD. Here the probability is 50%. In our case, let's assume that the LOD 1 has been sampled. Now, for a given LOD, we have to sample a cell according to the weight of all cells within the pixel footprint. Let's assume that we have sampled this cell. Now, we have to sample the two 1D distributions associated with the sample cell. The two 1D distributions correspond to the slope distribution in the X and Y direction of the surface, respectively. Here, we use the inversion method to sample the 1D distributions by using a binary search in the pre-computed CDFs of these distributions. These two 1D slopes samples are combined and give a 2D slope. The transformation M then transforms the 2D slope sample, and this is the end of our sampling procedure. The algorithm I have just described samples the glittering PSDF. The sampled slope is then converted to a normal. Then the reflection or transmission operator is applied on the normal to have a sample of the BSDFs. Now I will talk about the implementation and the validation tests. We implemented our important sampling scheme into the PBRTV3 renderer. Our implementation is located at this GitHub address. Our implementation has a low memory footprint, 384 KB, compared to the previous method, which stores only piecewise linear PDFs. We need to store the CDF of the PDFs to import and sample them. More details about the sampling implementation are available in the paper. To validate our important sampling scheme, we use the chi-squared test. This test compares the probability density function and the histogram built by sampling the PDF numerous times and accumulating the samples. If the difference is low, then the test passes and the important sampling procedure correctly samples the targeted PDF. Here, the PDF is a glittering BRDF plotted in the projected hemispherical domain without the shadowing term. The test passes for various roughness and microfacet density parameters. In addition to the chi-squared test, you will find convergence curves and the demonstration of our algorithm's correctness in the paper. Now I'm going to present our results. Here we have spheres made of glittering color glass. The density of glitter is spatially varying. On the top row, a point light is inside the spheres. On the bottom row, the spheres are lit by a gray environment map and the reflectance coefficient is set to 1. We use similar rendering times on the left and the right, but on the left, we use our sampling procedure and on the right, the sampling procedure using the monolobe component. In the middle, there is the referencing. Our important sampling scheme leads to less variance compared to the previous method on the right. Note that Firefly's artifacts are removed because the weights of the BSDF sampling never exceeds 1. The Fireflies are more visible in the white fronestats than in the rendering. Here, you can see the same comparison, but with a glittering conductor, a copper one. Note that using the multi-lobe component of the BRDF is also crucial for opaque glittering surfaces because fireflies can appear at grazing angles. Here, a scene with glittering conductors and dielectrics. Above uses our sampling, below uses a previous sampling. Both uses similar rendering times. Note that our sampling is more effective with glittering dielectrics. Now I will talk about limitations and future work. Currently, samples that are shadowed by the microsurface are lost. Our method could benefit from the techniques simulating multi-bonds in a V cavity. Another limitation is that we cannot see the geometry of the glitter. In other words, we cannot see the microsurface as for glossy BSDFs. An interesting future work could be filtering microsurface represented by normal maps into glittering BSDF parameters as lean and leader mapping do for glossy BSDFs. Our work provides an important sampling scheme of the analytic glittering BSDF of Sharma and colleagues. We also demonstrate that sampling of the monolobe approximation of a glittering BSDF leads to a poor convergence rate. To finish, we provide an open source implementation available at this link. Merci. Thank you.
Thanks, Xavier, for the great presentation.
Thank you.
Any questions for the audience? So I have one question. Regarding your future work, you mentioned about the multiple scattering and both of the multiple scattering methods are based on weak rule. So I'm wondering why do you choose this weak rule for multiple scattering, not other options like the random walk?
In our work, we assume that the microsurface is composed of V grooves. We cannot use the Smith's model. We do not have an analytic solution of the Smith masking with our model. Right. So we have to use the V cavity masking model. And so we believe that we can use the multi-bounces method using V-grooves.
Yep, makes a lot of sense. Okay, so I have another question. I noticed that in your result, there's a layered material with coatings. And in that case, how to sample that? For example, we have a coating and then it's the glittering BSDF. In this case, we may have an indirect footprint. Is this the case or how to handle that?
We have a base material. If the glitter doesn't cover all the surface, if there is some hole, some base material. We sample the base material in this case. In our model, if the cell, if a cell within the pixel footprint is not a glitter, we sample the BSDF of the base material. So we have to combine both sampling procedure, the sampling of multi-lobe BSDF and sampling of the base material. But we, in our implementation, we combined two material. That's right.
Okay, makes sense. Thank you. We have one question from the audience. Why was the furnace example not invisible?
Yes, it's a good question. It's related to multiple scattering. In our work, we do not model multiple scattering of light within the microsurface. If we have a rough surface, we have a lot of leaking energy. When we render a white, when we do a white furnace test, some part of the sphere can be darker because we lost energy due to the shadowing term. But we think that using the work using multi-bounces in a V cavity can lead to a perfect white furnace test.
Okay, thanks. So if we do not have further questions, let's thank Xavier again for the great talk.
Thank you.
And thank you.
Goodbye.
And bye. And then let's move to the next paper. The next paper is Practical Product Sampling for Single Scattering in Medium by Kevin Villeneuve, Andrew Grusin, Yilin Georgiev, and Derek Noru Zodari. Sorry for the pronunciation. Okay, Kevin is going to give the talk. Welcome.
Hi. Hi, I'm Kevin Villeneuve, and I'll be presenting our work, Practical Product Sampling for Single Scattering in Media. The main goal of our work is to render exciting and wonderful images like these more efficiently by getting rid of the noise as much as possible. While producing beautiful images, volumetry can get quite complicated. Light is affected by the medium, which means that contrary to surface rendering, we need to integrate the contribution of the light source along the ray, which can get quite expensive. The problem is challenging even a much simpler scene such as this one, where a single point light scatters in a homogeneous medium. We will show how we can significantly improve this situation using our method. So in this work, we focus on this much simpler context. Without breaking generalization, we only consider the elimination of a point source directly scattering within an homogeneous medium. Here we assume that the light is inside the medium. Our method can also be used for heterogeneous media as well, but at the cost of more variance, of course. We usually compute this integral using a Monte Carlo estimator. The efficiency of this estimator can be improved by using suitable important sampling techniques to choose a distance along the ray. Even in this much simpler situation, the variance can be caused by many different factors. First, the anisotropy of the phase function. There's also the transmittance from the camera ray and the light source, which attenuates the light along the ray. And finally, there's the geometric term with the distance falloff and the cosine for shortening on the light source. The term is represented by n in the equation. An efficient sampling solution should try to take into account all of those terms, and this is what we attempt in our work. In particular, we are interested in sampling the product of all those terms. Previously, Equiangular sampling proposed to important sample the distance falloff of the geometric term. By reformulating the problem into the angular domain, the distance falloff factor moves out of the integral, meaning that this term will be important sample just by doing this transformation. The sampling problem can then be simply seen as sampling an angle theta along the ray instead of a distance. The distance is referenced, the angle is referenced from the light source and goes on either side of the ray. Kula and al. Propose to sample this angle uniformly between theta min and theta max, the beginning and end of the ray. The resulting scheme is simple and completely analytical, making it a practical solution to be easily integrated into industrial path tracers. In order to account for the case where the light source is backfacing the ray, we can change the integration domain to exclude the regions where the light source does not contribute. These new integration bounds can then be computed based on where the light source normal hits the ray. In our work, we propose to extend equiangular sampling to account for the full geometric term by also including the cosine for shortening term. Like equiangular sampling, we use the angular domain to implicitly important sample the distance falloff term. In contrast, we sample an angle proportionally to the cosine term between the normal of the light source and the ray. To design this new important sampling scheme, we must first parameterize the cosine for shortening term as a function of an angle theta. Notice the plane containing the ray omega and the light source perpendicular distance on the ray h. Since this angle theta is referenced from h, in this plane, each component of the vector is simply the cosine and sine of this angle. The normal can then be transformed to this plane by doing a projection of each of its components along h and omega. We can then compute the cosine for shortening term that we're looking for as the dot product between the vectors theta and omega. After this step, we derive the new sampling scheme using the so-called inversion method. This method necessitates to first integrate the desired PDF, to compute the CDF, we then normalize the PDF and CDF, and finally the CDF must be inverted to be able to sample from the target PDF. In our case, the resulting PDF can be analytically integrated and inverted. A, B, C, D here are constants that depend on the light source normal and the ray. In our case, the resulting PDF can be analytically integrated and inverted. The CDF has two solutions. Only one of them is valid for any given situation. The one is between theta min and theta max. We now show some results of this method. First, in a simple scene composed of a single point normal light oriented up in an isotropic medium. The inset shows the SMAP error against the equiangular sampling on the left. We can see that our method outperforms equiangular sampling at equal time. In this situation, the only remaining noise is caused by the transmittance factor. On a more complex scene with a mesh light such as this one, we get noticeable variance reduction compared to equiangular sampling, especially around the light source where the cosine factor has more impact. To better visualize this improvement, we can visualize the SMAP error map. Once again, we can see that our method converges faster than equiangular sampling. Note that we use adaptive tree splitting with a splitting factor of 0.4 in order to reduce the sources of noise as much as possible. These images were rendered at one sample per pixel with anti-aliasing disabled. We will now see how to import and sample the other terms of the volume rendering equation. Similarly to the cosine term, we prioritize the phase function in the angular domain. This is trivial to do since the phase function is already a function of an angle. We use HG here for the anisotropic phase function. The relationship between the angle theta and the angle from the phase function is theta plus pi over 2, as can be seen as this diagram. The transmittance can also be easily transformed to the angular domain by doing a little bit of trigonometry. Unfortunately, both transmittance and phase function cannot be integrated analytically, so we cannot use the inversion method as is. Our solution is to approximate these terms using a polynomial approximation. The solution to integral of polynomial is simple and well known. It is also often the case that the CEF cannot be inverted analytically. One then resolves using numerical root finding methods such as Newton-Raphson. In our work, we choose to explore the use of Taylor series expansion to obtain a polynomial of order n that can be integrated. Since it's a polynomial, the CEF is straightforward, but not the inverse. For the inverse, we use numerical inversion. The curve in blue is the reference function, while the curve in orange is the Taylor approximation. In our case, we find that an order 6 provides the best trade-off between accuracy and computation time. We can see on this figure that our approximation gets worse as we get away from the expansion point. In some situation, the Taylor expansion can overshoot so badly that a PDF becomes negative, which makes it invalid to be used in a Monte Carlo estimator. Thankfully, it only happens in a very particular region of the function. So to resolve this issue, we clamp our Taylor expansion beyond a certain angle. This angle is a function fit on the plot of the PDF. Please see the paper for more details. On this slide, we show a comparison between this technique and equiangular sampling at equal time. The figure on the right, rendered using our method, is practically converged. The only noise left comes from the error in the approximation of the transmittance terms. We now have all the tools to import and sample the product of the geometric term with the Taylor expansion of a given function, such as transmittance or phase function. We integrate the PDF of our Taylor product to obtain the CDF. The CDF is a polynomial of higher order and thus cannot be inverted analytically, so we default to use the Newton-Raphson method to sample from the target PDF. Our Newton solver only requires a few iterations to converge to the solution on this CDF. This is the previous result we've shown for the point normal light scene, where we only sample with our analytical point normal scheme. And here's the result with our approximate product of the Taylor expansion of the transmittance and the point normal. We can see that most of the noise disappears. On the Buddha scene, we obtain substantial variance reduction compared to equiangular sampling as well. The remaining question is how we can sample the product of all the terms together. One potential solution is to do the Taylor expansion of the product of the transmittance and the phase function. However, this requires a higher order polynomial. A more practical solution is to use the idea developed by Hart and colleagues in 2020 inside their practical product sampling paper. In this paper, the author proposed to transform an initial random numbers using a Bayesian warp. This new random number C prime is then used to do our approximate product like shown just before. With this approach, we can, for example, use a Bayesian warp to model the phase function and handle the two remaining terms with our technique. Or we could use the transmittance as a warp. The choice of which term to use in the warp depends on how strong the transmittant is compared to the phase function one. For now, we pick the one that works the best in practice. On these equal time renders, we can see that the variance is significantly reduced in both scenes when we use our method that takes into account all terms of the volume rendering equation. Finally, we show results on another scene which contained a mesh light in a dense homogeneous medium. In this scene, all three terms of the volume rendering equation have great impact on the illumination of the scene. Our product sampling technique on the right performs the best. In summary, we have developed a new analytical importance sampling method to sample the cosine foreshortening term and the distance falloff of a point normal light inside an homogeneous medium. We've also seen how a Taylor expansion can be used as an alternative to Bezier warp to do product sampling. And finally, we have derived an approximate sampling scheme to sample the product of all the terms in the rendering equation using warp composition. Interesting future work includes specialization to planar lights, mesh lights, or even heterogeneous media, but also handling refractive medium boundaries, since in our work, we assume that it's easy to construct a path between the light source and a sample point. This concludes our talk. Thank you for listening.
Thanks, Kevin. Great work. Any questions? So I have one question. So there are several options to sample the product of several functions. So I'm wondering how to choose them. Like the combination of the Bezier warp and the Taylor expansion. So how can we combine them and choose the best?
This is actually kind of a ongoing work. For now, we just choose whatever works best in practice, but it's definitely a interesting future work to look into this, a more mathematical way to approach this.
You mentioned that in the future work, to extend the current work to the heterogeneous medium, could you please talk about how to do that? Or any ideas about that?
We didn't really get into heterogeneous media in this work, but since it's a Monte Carlo estimator, there's no reason why it couldn't just be applied to heterogeneous media as well. We could do some work on that to attempt to apply our technique to heterogeneous media, since maybe a piecewise or some approximation.
Sounds great. And also the Taylor expansion sounds a general idea for sampling. Do you think, is it possible to use this idea for the surface sampling? Like we have the BSDF and we have the incoming readings distribution. Can we use the current idea for that?
I think it's possible. However, it worked well in our case of volume rendering where the function are pretty smooth. So in surface, it might be more like specular or less smooth, which could cause problem where the PDF could become negative and we need to handle that case, which could be tricky.
Okay, thank you. So if we do not have further questions, let's thank Kevin again for the great work. And also, I think it's the end of the session. And thank all the speakers again for the presentations. And thank you all for the attention. And before that, we have our second keynote at 16. See you.
All right, welcome. So I'm again very pleased to introduce our second keynote, Roland Fleming. So Roland did his PhD at MIT with Ted Adelson, and he's now a professor of experimental psychology at Giessen University. Roland Fleming works on the perception of material properties, glossiness, translucency, viscosity, which are effects that we strive to simulate in computer graphics. And I think that's where our two research fields connect. Very early in his PhD, Roland Fleming used computer graphics simulation to generate control stimuli for his experiments, such as material samples under different lighting conditions to study how people perceive gloss. But he also used his findings to improve image synthesis, for instance, to modify material appearance in photographs. More recently, he started to investigate neural networks, but his goal is not to train a network to outperform humans in, let's say, classification tasks, as in computer vision, but he rather uses neural networks as a tool to better understand human perception or even misperception. I will conclude by mentioning that Roland received a number of awards, including the Young Investigator Award by the Vision Science Society and an ERC Consolidator grant. So Roland, thank you again for accepting our invitation, and the stage is yours.
Oh, thank you so much for inviting me. I'm really delighted to be here. It's been a long time since I last came to EGSR. I think the last time was in Sarajevo, so that was a few years ago now, but I'm just super delighted that I'm able to join you. Let me just see if I can get my screen up like this. Okay, so I can't see you guys, but hopefully you can see my slides. Somebody please shout out if you can't see my slides. Okay, so before I dive straight into the talk, I just want to set expectations appropriately. I'm a psychologist, okay? So I'm going to be talking about how we see stuff. That's what my research program is about, how we try to work out how the brain allows us to see. And so I'm not going to be dazzling you with any algorithms. I'm not going to give you any code porn or anything like that. There's going to be a little bit of eye candy, some philosophizing, and hopefully something that you can take home with you that inspires you to think about the human visual system and how it can impact your research. Okay, so it's called Learning to See Stuff, particularly because I focus on materials, stuff. And it's amazing that every single time we open our eyes, we take this for granted, but we immediately gain access to this incredibly rich world of visual sensations. So without reaching out and touching an object, we usually have a pretty clear idea of what it would feel like. We can tell the surface shape, whether something is hard or soft, wet or dry, rough or smooth, whether something is heavy or light, is it, you know, standing upright or is it going to fall over? We can identify risks and pleasures, predict how something would respond if we interact with it. All of these judgments, all of these inferences that we're making based on a pattern of light that lands on our eyes, right? So that's a challenge. And the properties, the material and physical properties of surfaces and materials that we interact with, they really make up the essence of our everyday percepts. You know, as you're a kid going around exploring things, materials just ooze and pop into your everyday experiences. And of course, what something is made out of also has a big impact on its value to us. So this particular form of carbon is presumably valuable, not just because it's relatively rare and it's durable, but because it kind of glistens in this intriguing and beguiling way that attracts the eye. And people are willing to pay top dollar for this kind of carbon. And of course, as behaving organisms going around the world trying to interact with things, the physical state of our surroundings is very important. These are the evolutionary pressures that have shaped our visual system. So working out whether the ground is safe to tread on, working out whether something is good to eat. And so material perception is really one of the most important aspects of our vision, our visual systems, but surprisingly little research has been done on it relative to, for example, object recognition or 3D shape perception. And I would argue that due to their extreme diversity and their complexity, and their mutability, materials pose unique challenges for the human visual system. And we can ask many research questions connected to this, like how does the brain infer the physical properties of objects and materials? And how do we visually reason about materials and their typical behaviors? And then, you know, things that maybe even have industrial applications as well, things like what exactly is appearance? How can we measure it and model it and understand it? So that's what my research program's about. But I think maybe for those of you who are not used to thinking so much about the opposite side of the screen, so that is not the generation of images, but the interpretation of images, it may come as a bit of a surprise to find out that vision is such a challenge because it's so effortless for us. So this is the number one, the first take-home message I just want to leave you with is just that vision is difficult, okay? So it needs a lot of brain power. So what I'm showing you here are representations, two different ways of representing visual areas in the monkey brain, the macaque monkey brain. And you can see so over on the left-hand side, you can see a map of cortical regions laid out. And all the ones that have color are ones that in some way represent visual information. And you can see it's like a third of cortex, right? So a huge amount of brain power is involved. And there are all these different regions and they're connected in these complicated ways as shown on the right-hand side. So it's like, it's nearly a third of primate cortex. It's literally billions of neurons that are involved. And the question you wanna ask then is just, well, why? Is seeing really so difficult? The main reason seeing is difficult, the reason vision is difficult is because of ambiguity. Vision is highly ambiguous. So the image that we receive on the retina is a complex mix of shape, lighting, surface material properties, and of course the viewpoint as well. And what the brain has to do is somehow decompose the image into these distinct contributions, so disentangle these physical factors that have been smooshed together in the image. And so the perception of a surface or perception of surface properties in general is an inference from ambiguous information. And because of this, so we can express that formally by saying vision is, it's an under-constrained or ill-posed problem. And those of you who've thought about computer vision will be familiar with this idea, but of course it's a challenge for the human visual system and no one can come in and engineer it. Only evolution and learning can lead to internal representations that can overcome these ambiguities. So here's a concrete example of that ambiguity in action. We got a 2D image as input that comes from a 3D world. And it's common to separate these two terms that we refer to a lot in vision, which is the proximal stimulus. That's the pattern of light, the proximal sensations that you get, that you're measuring with your rods and cones in your eye. And then there's the distal stimulus, which is usually what we're actually really interested in as behaving organisms. That's the structure of the 3D world. So what we as behaving organisms care about is the 3D structure of the world. But unfortunately, the projection from 3D to 2D is not invertible. So what that means is that for any given pattern of light, there's potentially an infinite family of different three-dimensional worlds which could have produced exactly the same image on the eye. And that's the ambiguity. And because of this ambiguity, we experience various kinds of illusions. So this is a pretty famous image. It was created by Ted Adelson, my thesis supervisor. I actually wouldn't count this as an illusion. This is an example of the visual system succeeding, okay? So patch A and patch B, they are the same luminance, the same intensity on the retina, but we see them as very different shades of gray. And I can just show you that they are actually the same because I take this rectangle and join them up. You can see they're the same. But we don't perceive it that way. And that's not an error of the visual system. It's not really an illusion. It's the visual system succeeding because, you know, the patch B is in shadow. And so we should see it as lighter if it's projecting the same luminance onto the eye as patch A, which is in direct illumination. Okay. Here's another example showing you how context plays a big role in visual perception. This is from Bart Anderson, who was actually my other thesis supervisor. So here you can see two identical patches of texture. And when I just embed those in different contexts, you get radically different interpretations of what's going on. So on the left-hand side, you see a white disk hidden behind black clouds. On the right-hand side, you see a black disk hidden behind white clouds. The image is pixel for pixel identical in the middle. Clearly, the visual system is using the context to segment and interpret and structure its interpretation of the stimulus. Okay, so getting back to materials, there are obviously many different sources of information that we could use to infer material properties. I mean, in everyday life, when we talk about materials, we're often referring to the texture of materials, so leather and wool and things like this. They've got different spatial structures. We can use 3D shape. I'll talk about that for a few moments in a moment, because different materials self-organize into different characteristic shapes. You know, if it's got sharp edges, it's probably not a liquid. Motion, the way that things change their shape over time. Many materials can evoke particular material impressions by the way they move. And what I'm going to focus on for the core of the talk is actually the first area of material perception that really got studied, which is the optical properties, the way that light interacts with surfaces so that you get appearance characteristics like gloss, for example. Okay, but I'm going to start off by talking about shape just because this is an area that people have not really done much research on. But if you think about it, shape has to be one of the most important sources of visual information about materials, because the whole of classical sculpture is predicated on this idea. So here's this beautiful carving. It's made out of a single homogeneous block of marble or alabaster. And the artist, with incredible skill, has hewn this into particular forms that have very evocative impressions of shape, so of material. So we're able to infer not just that this is a figure, a corpse lying prone, right? But we can also see that it's whelmed in cloth. And we can make judgments about the quality of that cloth. It looks like it's thin, it looks like it's wet, it's clinging to the body in particular ways. And all of that is conveyed entirely by the shape of the object, right? Here's another beautiful example. This is just a remarkable piece of sculpture, I've got to say. I mean, this is one single block of marble. You can imagine the strain of the guy. Apparently, it took him 7 years to make this, right? Imagine you're on the last day of the seventh year, you're doing the last bit, and you chip through one of those pieces of rope and ruin it. That would be a nightmare. Anyway, what you can see when you look at this is an incredibly vivid impression of the material properties. You don't just see the shape. You see the rope, you see the tension in the rope, you see the weight of the rope, the friction of the rope. All of these are visual inferences that are based on the static shape of this form. So shape can convey a lot about a material. Here's just one more example from Bernini. You can see again just the indentations in the flesh. They just give us such a vivid impression of what the physical characteristics are. We've done a bit of research on this ourselves. So we had a paper last year in PNAS where we asked participants to make inferences about the causal origin of shape features. So this is this veiled virgin carving, amazing carving that gives you the impression of transparency, even though there are no optical indications of transparency, only the shape. And we wanted to just confirm that participants can separate out the different causal origins of shape features within this shape. So some of the features are caused by the cloth, the textile, organizing itself under its own tension, its own physical properties that cause it to make these ripples and folds. And other shape properties are caused by the face protruding through this diaphanous veil. So underneath, it's hidden behind it, but it's kind of pushing through and therefore shaping the front surface of the material. So we find that participants are extremely good at doing this. So we show them this on an iPad and get them to color it. And you can see the stuff that's colored in yellow, that's where they perceived it as being due to the cloth. And where it's colored blue, that's due to the underlying surface. And then we verified that this is not just this special thing to do with faces, but it works with a bunch of unrecognizable objects as well. So objects you've never seen before, you can also separate out which ripples in the surface are due to cloth and which ones are due to an object that's hidden inside that cloth. Okay. So, you know, what is the challenge? What is it? So different physical materials, they have these properties that cause them to respond in different ways to external forces. So here we've got, for example, silk. Silk is all slinky and you know, it's low friction. And so it's going to tend to organize itself into these flatter regions with crisper edges. Whereas the wool is all springy and high friction. And so it tends to make these larger undulating mounds. And so materials self-organize themselves into specific 3D shapes. And so that's why we can use shape to make inferences about material properties. But here's the challenge. Any given material can take on many different shapes. So here in this case, I've taken the same silk handkerchief and draped it three times, and each time you end up with a different shape. Essentially, every time you interact with this thing, you're going to get a unique shape coming out. And yet somehow we're able to abstract certain characteristics that these different shapes have in common with one another, and work out that they evoke the same material properties. So that's the challenge for the visual system. How does the visual system recognize that they're the same material despite these changes in shape? And one particularly vivid realm within which to investigate this is liquids, because they're materials that change their shape a lot. And we've done some studies. I'm not going to go into details with loads of data or something. I just want to give you a hint of the kind of research that we do, taking those ideas and using computer graphics to give us the stimuli that we need in order to perform our experiments. So when we're talking about variations between liquids like this, viscosity is probably the most important difference between the liquids in terms of determining what shape they end up with. Of course, there are other properties as well, like the elasticity and things like that, but viscosity is the lion's share of what's going on. So we asked, how does the brain infer viscosity? I just want to show you just some fun movies that Yan-Yap van Assen, who was working in my lab, he generated these using software from Next Limit Technologies, based in Madrid, who have a really nice liquid solver. This is their hybrido engine, which uses a combination of particles and level sets methods to simulate freely flowing liquids. I think they look gorgeous. There are a few artifacts in a few places that you can probably see. This is a graphics audience, so I'm not gonna try to pull the wool over your eyes, but I still think they look pretty good. We get a very vivid impression of liquids with different viscosities coming out of these stimuli here. And let me just show you that same challenge again. So in this case, all six of these liquids, they got exactly the same viscosity. And when we look at them, they look like they're basically the same kind of liquid. They seem to move with the same rhythm. They seem to have the same kind of shape features. But each one, due to a little perturbation at the beginning, ends up in a different configuration, right? Somehow the visual system has to abstract across those variations and work out that all of those are the same liquid and they're different from another liquid that flows and splashes in different ways. And so, you know, the great thing about graphics from my point of view as a researcher in human vision is that you can make these parametric arrays where you hold everything constant and just vary one parameter. So in this case, varying, for example, the viscosity of the liquid, and you can see how it goes through different phases of different kinds of behavior. And then we get participants to make judgments of the viscosity, and then we do analyses to try to work out what are the cues that they're using to work out the viscosity from that. So this is a kind of typical example of a task. They're adjusting the slider, and that lets them report how viscous they see the liquid as being. Okay. We test also not just in this one fixed condition, but also where we have varying conditions. And that's really the key challenge for the visual system, is can it generalize? Some of these might be scenes that you've never seen liquids interacting with before. Like, you've maybe seen water going through a water wheel, but you've probably never seen thick stuff like this going through a water wheel or getting smeared with a knife or whatever. So we're interested in understanding how the visual system generalizes, and that's the big challenge. And just in brief summary form, the main idea is that we think that by representing statistical characteristics of the way that the shape changes over time, it's possible to abstract out those things that a liquid has in common across changes in the settings. That's the main way that we think visual system achieves this task of generalization. Okay, so that was just a little flavor of some of the research on shape and motion. Now let me just switch over and talk for the last part of the talk about surface reflectance estimation. So here's a bunch of spheres, and they all look this. They look different from one another because they have different surface reflectance properties. They're all under the same lighting. They're all the same shape, but they have distinctive appearances. And in everyday language, of course, we use words like color and gloss and luster to distinguish between these things. As you guys know, the best way to describe the full physics of what's going on with these kinds of materials is using a BRDF. And so if you're a computer vision researcher, it's very tempting to formulate the goal of vision as being estimating the BRDF. Now that's pretty challenging because this is a high dimensional function, even ignoring the fact that it's ill-posed, which I'll get onto in a moment, but it's a high dimensional function. as you guys probably know, of course, it gets a bit easier because the space of real BRDFs, if you sample real materials, is a tiny subspace of all mathematically possible BRDFs, and that's allowed the development of analytical models. Here's one that I've used, the Ward model. I don't know if you're all groaning and shaking your head because that's out of date nowadays. I know that it doesn't include Fresnel term and other stuff, but it's been incredibly useful for us trying to identify some of the cues that the human visual system uses to distinguish highlights and reflective surfaces. But I want to get philosophical for a moment. I want to step back and challenge that conventional inverse optics computer vision way of thinking about what vision does, because vision is biological and it's evolved in a context where there's no engineers to plant the correct supervised learning objective into the brain. So let's step back and think about this from first principles. So you're faced with a proximal stimulus, a pattern of light that lands on the eye. And this is the result of complex interactions between multiple distal seeing factors. So for example, if I take an image and I change the lighting, then the image changes in systematic ways. And if I change the shape, then the image changes, but in other systematic ways. And if I change the reflectance, then the image changes again in systematic ways, but again, different systematic ways. This hints at the problem of trying to disentangle these different causes, shape and lighting and so on. And that is related to this fundamental ambiguity. So consider, for example, this ideal chrome sphere. If you think about it, the image of that sphere consists of nothing more than a distorted reflection of the world surrounding the object. So if I take that same sphere and put it in a new setting, all of the pixels change, right? And yet it's the same material. So somehow I've got to work out that these two things are the same, even though the pixels are completely different. And conversely, different materials can actually lead to very similar images. So perceptually, we see the top row as similar and the bottom row as similar, but different from one another. Okay, but actually on a pixel by pixel basis, the images on the left and the images on the right are more similar to one another in the vertical direction. And that's just because of the positions of the highlights and the shadows and so on, because the illumination is playing a larger role in determining the spatial configuration of the intensities in the pixels. So the visual system has to somehow take stimuli that are similar to one another and tease them apart, and take stimuli that are different from one another and bring them together in its internal representation. That's disentanglement. And that is really, that's the main challenge that I think the visual system is really trying to solve. Because it's very, traditionally, it's very common to pose vision as this thing of inverse optics, where you have a set of predefined physical characteristics of the world, and your goal with a visual system is just to reconstruct those properties. And so, for example, you've got things like the size, or the distance between objects, which we as rational investigators can think about as being meaningful properties of the world, or for example, surface orientation or reflectance properties like the BRDF. Okay, so it's very easy to formulate vision as the goal is, given the proximal stimulus, find out these specific physical characteristics of the world, infer those, estimate those by solving this inverse optics problem. But what I'm going to suggest to you is that actually we need to go beyond inverse optics as a way of thinking about how vision emerged. Because as we are evolving and growing up during our childhood, we have to work out not just how to estimate things, but we need to work out what to estimate in the first place. Somehow the visual system has to know that there are distinct physical characteristics of the world that we need to tease apart. And there are many reasons for doubting the conventional inverse optics idea that we somehow get born or planted with ideas about what the physical characteristics of the world are out there in the world, and we just learn a mapping between images and those characteristics. I mean, one of the problems is the fact that there's no way to educate the senses. We never get access to ground truth. Okay, so you might say, well, the other senses could educate your visual system, but that's not true because, for example, most points in the world are out of reach, and how are you ever going to smell, taste, or touch the color of a surface? It's a purely visual characteristic, And so the idea of training through supervision doesn't make any sense. Training signals are too sparse. They're in many cases non-existent. And in fact, there are even certain kinds of characteristics where it's not even really clear what the ground truth should be. If I say something like, you know, how old is the jug, visually speaking, right? I don't mean give me a carbon dating on the jug. I mean, tell me about its appearance. Does it look like an antique or does it look like something modern? That's not a physical characteristic in the same way as distance is, right? Or for example, how ripe is the pear? It's kind of ludicrous to suggest that the visual system learns to recognize ripe pears by measuring the amount of sugar in the pear or something like this. So there are these characteristics where it's just not very well defined. Or for example, you've got like a pilling on your jumper, right? What do you mean to say that it looks bobbly, right? What are you estimating? You're not really estimating anything. There's an appearance characteristic that makes it look that way. So I don't think that we learn by supervised learning. I think that's impossible. But what we do get to do is observe massive amounts of data, lots of proximal stimuli. They come flooding in from the moment we're born, okay? So what I'm going to propose is that the human visual system, what structures the human visual system, is actually objective functions that deal not with the distal stimulus, but with the proximal stimulus, the patterns of light themselves. And I'm going to suggest to you that, for example, if we want to define what the goal of vision is, it's to learn to encode and predict the input as efficiently and accurately as possible. And by doing so, the hope is that you learn representations that will do a good job of disentangling distal factors. Okay, and the intuition here, maybe I should talk about this first. So this is a way of posing what is actually the biggest statistical problem in vision, which is not the inference of the outside world, but is simply just encoding within finite brain resources the diversity of images that you're going to experience in the natural world. Because natural images are not representative, they're not representative of random samples from the space of images. So let's keep the dimensionality small by considering kind of 45 by 45 pixel thumbnails. That's about, you've got about 2000 dimensions, each dimension varying independently. If you just take random samples, almost all of them are going to look like random noise. And as a behaving organism, I don't need to be able to distinguish those. I can treat them as an equivalence class because I'm never going to really encounter them. What I really want to do is distinguish between that set of images that occur, that are likely to occur from the real world. Okay, I want to learn a representation, given my limited brain resources, that allows me to distinguish these as optimally as possible. Okay, and that's, so we want to learn something that conforms to the subspace of natural images. And the reason why this is possible, or why this can tell us about the structure of the outside world, is because those images are generated by latent generative processes, latent variables out there in the world that structure the images and give them their statistical characteristics, the relationships between pixel values across space in very high orders. Okay. And these kinds of latent variables, they're everything from the physics of the outside world, like the fact, like specular reflection or something like that, or gravity, to rules that are far away from physics, like the fact that faces have two eyes, or shirts tend to have a row of vertical buttons, or bicycles have two wheels, or something like this. And in fact, many of you may be familiar with these kinds of images. These are not photographs at all. These are images generated by various kinds of deep learning networks that have been trained using unsupervised training objectives, where they just have to learn to encode in various ways statistical relationships between pixel values. And for example, these faces, they're the result of a network that was trained on images of celebrities, and none of these are recognizable people, but they all look like the kind of person you would see on the front cover of a glossy magazine. Subtle details of appearance are captured here. The gloss of the flash photography on the skin, details of the shape of the face, bags under the eyes. It's just incredible what can be learned without any explicit representation of the physical structure. There's no physics rendering, there's no subsurface light scattering, there's nothing going on here. It's just pixels, high order pixel statistics. And I think that that's what the visual system is also trying to do. It's trying to learn a generative model that accurately represents the proximal stimulus. And this is really, you know, this deep learning revolution has just changed all our lives, right? Like, you know, 20 years ago, certainly when I was an undergraduate, computer vision just didn't work, right? You'd show it an image, you'd be like, what's this? And it'll be like, oh, there's a boat. And it's just completely hopeless, right? But, you know, now deep learning has basically pretty much solved object recognition and detection, right? You just show it an image, it can find everything that's in there. And, you know, you can do segmentation, labeling, you can do 3D reconstruction. Lots of these results I'm showing you, these are from a few years ago now. These are not even the state of the art in what people can achieve. And of course, image synthesis as well. I mean, these remarkable results from DALL-E, which I guess some of you have probably seen before. So given a text prompt, in this case, a cross-section view of a walnut, it generates images like these. I mean, this is just amazing. They look like photographs. Or a snail made of harp. So this is combining two concepts of which there is no exemplar in the real world, as far as I'm aware. And it's able to synthesize new objects that have, you know, characteristics in common with a snail and a harp. It's really, really amazing. Now, I don't want to give you the impression that, you know, everything works perfectly. There are still failure cases as well. So for example, I typed in text to image into Google, and I ended up on this guy's page. Something's not working very well here. So I typed in a visit to the supermarket goes horribly wrong, and you get this synthesized image. Yeah, it's actually, I don't know, maybe that makes sense. I don't know, maybe there's a story behind that. Ballet at its finest gives us this weird kind of bulletproof vest thing. The next president of the USA, I don't know, maybe it's some kind of dark satirical comment on politics. The person who is in charge of the EU, yeah, okay, maybe the vaccine program didn't quite go according to plan. So yeah, and then I was like, yeah, maybe it just doesn't understand the real world. So I was like, okay, just tell me about myself, tell me my dream woman, and it synthesizes this. And I'm like, you know me much better than I know myself. Most beautiful person in the world, and you get this like hideous thing going on. The coolest car ever. I like this one a lot, actually. I would drive around in that. And I said, no, that's no good. Do it again. It's like, what is that? Weird kind of, I don't know, jellyfish on the screen. And then finally, future of electric vehicles. So if you're planning on moving from computer graphics to EVs, this is what you're going to be making. But then actually, I zoomed in and I was like, check that out. Look at the driver. It does know something about the future. The DNNs know more than we thought. Anyway, so that's all a lot of that is supervised learning. Okay. And that's not what we're going to be talking about. I'm going to finish just with one example from my own research, looking at unsupervised learning. And the species of unsupervised learning we're going to be using is autoencoders. Hopefully most of you are already familiar with this. This is just make sure we're all on the same page. So it takes an image as input, and it just has to produce the same image as output. It's completely trivial, except that it has to pass the image through this low bandwidth bottleneck. And that is a compression objective. It's saying, learn a small number of numbers that will let me reconstruct the image. Okay. So, this is a simple version of this, and you can train it with a set of images. And then it will be able to generate new images. And that's what we're using. We're using artificial images of fronto-parallel surfaces, these bumpy things with different surface reflectances. And we're going to then study the latent code that it has learned to try to represent these. In fact, the particular architecture we're using is a pixel VAE, which learns something a bit more sophisticated. I'm not going to go into all the details. You're welcome to ask me about it. It's basically, you can think of it as having kind of a prediction component, which is learning high order statistics. But the thing that we're really interested in is the compression component that it uses. It conditions on that. And we compress this image data set to just 10 numbers. Okay, so it's a 10-dimensional latent code, and it's got to reconstruct the diversity of all of these shiny, bumpy surfaces, okay? And the fascinating thing is what happens when you look inside this latent code. So this is a completely unsupervised objective. Just learn to create images that look like the training set. Doesn't know anything about reflectance, doesn't know anything about lighting or surface shape. It just gets to see lots of examples. And if we do a low-dimensional visualization of the raw pixel space, our image set is carefully designed to make it non-trivial to distinguish glossy from matte surfaces within our space. And that's shown over on the left-hand side here. So this is a TSNE embedding. Hopefully that's familiar to some of you guys. It's a two-dimensional embedding. So you can see the spatial arrangement of these shows how similar they are to one another. And the light dots are high gloss surfaces and the dark dots are low gloss surfaces. And they're all just jumbled together. So in the raw pixel space, they're very difficult to tell apart. But inside the pixel VAE model, we see them neatly and cleanly separated from one another. So in principle, this kind of learning, just learning to represent those statistics of the natural world, can teach a visual system without any explicit supervision how to disentangle different kinds of surfaces. It says there's some kind of surfaces that generate this kind of appearance, with speckly highlights on them, and then there's this other kind of surface that doesn't. And so in my latent space, I'm going to be able to compress those images most effectively if I separate those out. Okay, so you can see those clusters here in this pixel VAE model. And that's not just true for that one dimension of our space. It also separates out other characteristics as well. So we generated the images with different light fields, and you can see the different light fields are clustered together in the glossy case, but not so much in the matte case. That kind of makes sense visually, right? Because when it's a glossy surface, the appearance depends a lot on the lighting. And so you'll find these clusters in there. Whereas for the matte surface, the lighting has less of an impact on the image because it's a low pass representation, right? Like the good old studies from Ramamurti and Hanrahan showed. you can decode light orientation as well. So the lighting direction that's coming in, and even to a certain extent, the bump height, although that doesn't work quite so well. So tacitly, this unsupervised network has worked out how to disentangle these different physical factors. And we can contrast that with a supervised neural network that we trained explicitly with labels about how to distinguish high gloss from low gloss materials. And of course, it performs its objective function very well. That's shown on the left. It can easily distinguish high gloss from low gloss surfaces, but it doesn't need to learn anything about the light field or the surface relief to fulfill its objective, and so it doesn't learn anything about those. So you would have to posit that for every characteristic of the world, we have a separate explicit training signal in order for us to learn how to see, if that's your hypothesis about how the visual system emerges, rather than just having an all-purpose general representation based on the proximal stimulus. And we can then go in and read out from the neural network an estimate of what it thinks the gloss is. Of course, it doesn't know anything about gloss. We haven't taught it anything about gloss, but we can find the gloss discriminating axis within its latent space and then read out values. And we get intuitively interpretable outcomes from that. So if we show it new images that it's never seen before and read out where they occur within its latent space, then you see that they're organized with matte surfaces in one end and glossier surfaces in the other end, and that lets us read out its predictions, so to speak, its percepts of what the gloss is according to what it's learned. And then we can compare that with humans. And that's what the real goal of my research is can we model human visual judgments? And what we find is that the latent code learned by this unsupervised model actually predicts human judgments of gloss better than the ground truth does. So better than the true gloss does. And that's already quite intriguing. It's quite surprising in some ways, because it's like, well, if the visual system is optimized for estimating gloss, surely the ground truth, you would expect to predict human gloss perception better than the insides of this unsupervised learning model that's just trying to compress images. And another cool thing about this kind of model is that you can draw samples from it. So you can generate, synthesize new images. So we can take these two images here, and depending on where within the latent space we draw those samples, you can make either, for example, less glossy images. All of these are completely hallucinated by the network, by the way. Or we can make things that come from the glossier regions within its latent space, and they look glossier to humans as well. So it's clearly learned something about appearance but lines up with what humans have learned about appearance by observing surfaces. So that's one cool thing that you can do. But the real challenge of vision, explaining human vision, is to explain our constancy. And this is the ability to see a surface as constant despite changing conditions, okay? And in particular, what's particularly interesting are the failures of constancy. And that's illustrated with this this illusion here. So all three of these surfaces actually have identical surface reflectance, but most human observers see differences in reflectance here. So most people see the surfaces on the right-hand side as being glossier than the ones on the left-hand side. And all we're actually changing is the physical bump height. So there's a failure to disentangle, a failure of constancy, where we're interpreting changes of bump height as changes of reflectance, okay? And this is a well-documented illusion, but it's one that has kind of evaded explanation until now. It's not obvious why you should confuse bumpiness with glossiness, the two completely different characteristics of the world. Well, our explanation, or our proposed explanation, is it's failures of disentanglement, partial failures of disentanglement, because the learning objective only focuses on the proximal stimulus. It's just trying to learn statistics of the image. And it turns out that both bump height and glossiness can have interacting effects on the size and contrast of highlights, for example. And so then we can compare whether, well, we can test whether the unsupervised neural network also makes these errors of gloss perception. And if we show it this row of stimuli, they've all got the same reflectance characteristics, but we read out what the interpreted gloss is from the network, you can see that it's saying that some of them are more glossy than others, just like humans do. So it's already beginning to suffer from the same kind of illusions that humans do, indicating that maybe that's the way that humans learn to see. So we did this with a whole bunch of sequences where we carefully selected them to make sure that they had not just trivial linear increases, but sometimes non-monotonic changes. As we vary the bump height, the interpreted gloss that comes out of the network. And for comparison, so here are human judgments. And what you can see is that qualitatively speaking, this unsupervised network is capturing the same kind of tendencies that humans have to see variations in gloss as a function of the height of the bumps. And this is not at all a trivial finding, because our contrasting model, the supervised learning model, makes very different predictions. It also makes errors of constancy, but it makes different errors from the unsupervised network and different errors from the humans. And so this really suggests that it's unsupervised learning is what explains human perception rather than the supervised learning objective. And that's just shown again here. If we plot both of those in every case, it's always more similar to the unsupervised model than to the supervised model. And we didn't just do it against, you know, one supervised model. We tested against a whole bunch of other different kinds of models. And we find that this pixel VAE model, based on this compression and prediction objective, is getting much closer to humans than all of the alternatives that we tested out. Okay, so here are the key results that I've shown you. Different world factors, so things like shape and reflectance and lighting, can spontaneously emerge in unsupervised models' latent codes. And the unsupervised model predicts human perceived gloss both for novel rendered images and also for network generated images. The unsupervised model predicts failures of gloss constancy on a stimulus by stimulus basis, better than the supervised model, better than ground truth, and better than any other model that we tried out. So to wrap up the whole talk and give you the big picture conclusions, what I want to leave you with is that seeing stuff is a major computational challenge. It's amazing that we can see the outside world in all its richness and diversity. The way that we learn to see structures and affects the brain's visual representations. And I've suggested to you today that unsupervised learning objectives like spatial and temporal compression, prediction, contrast of learning, these kinds of things, they may be the key to explaining both the successes and the unique idiosyncratic failures of the human material perception and I believe vision more broadly. So with that, I'd like to thank all the guys in my group and the sponsors, and again, thank you guys for listening and for having me present.
Thank you very much. I see that already some questions appearing. So if you want, Juan Raul, do you want to ask your question directly? Otherwise, I will just phrase it. Yeah. So, well, first of all, I agree. Fantastic talk. So how does the visual system evolve from babies to adults with regard to the source of information? Are all of them equally important over time?
That is a fascinating question. I'm not an expert in developmental psychology, so there's a whole field that deals just with that kind of question. So if by source of information you mean which sensory modality, so for example, vision or touch or taste, it's certainly the case that the visual system develops over time and continues to develop over what seems to be a longer time scale than some of our other senses. So our sense of taste is usually pretty developed by the time we're 2 years old. There's evidence that our visual systems are still developing even in our teenage years. Now, you might not remember that because you remember seeing the world perfectly well when you were a teenager, but it turns out that if you make careful psychophysical measures, then you can see that there's still development going on. Okay. I see source of information, texture, 3D shape, motion, optical. That is not something that I'm aware that anybody has investigated. So one thing I can say is this. It's definitely known that 3D shape is the most important cue for determining what an object is perceived to be for an infant and also for animals as well. But for infants, if, for example, you show them a new object that they've never seen before, and you show them this thing, and you're like, this is a wobble. Okay, and you shake it in front of them. And then you take two new objects. One of them has the same material appearance and the other one has the same shape. And you ask them which one of these two is the wobble. Then they choose the one that has the same shape, not the one that has the same color or optical characteristics. Okay, so shape is probably the dominant thing. And it makes sense because shape is very high dimensional, right? So BRDFs are high dimensional too, but shape is even higher dimensional. So that's probably the main reason why. Sorry, that's kind of hot.
Yeah. Okay, so Sidens, do you want to ask your question live? Otherwise, okay. you can just
read
repeat the question. So for gross perception, is there a particular reason you chose frontal parallel bumpy images as opposed to more complex real-world scenes?
Yep, there's a reason. It's just because it was an easy starting place. We weren't sure how low dimensional we could really compress the images down to. The more diverse you make your training set, the more dimensions you're going to need to represent it. And we didn't know how well we were going to be able to match the dimensionality of the training set to the dimensionality of the model. So we said, let's start off with something simple. But I'm hoping that in ongoing research, we're going to be able to generalize. We're using temporal, so spatiotemporal video prediction objectives. And there we're using much more diverse things because you get to see the object changing in all the different directions. We're getting some pretty encouraging results from that. So it's not a fundamental limit that's only true for front parallel surfaces. It was just our starting place.
Thank you. So Gurpreet wanted to ask a question live.
Hi, Roland. Very fantastic talk. Really loved it. I was thinking when you were talking about this, how we perceive things and how we can really understand things better, but we are still very far from how we can computationally model these understandings, right? I mean, especially taking example from the way perception models work, like especially in computer vision or graphics, like HDR, VDP, things like that, if you have heard of that. Like, they somehow, I mean, there's a lot of research has been gone through in that to understand human visual system and to develop these metrics which can tell what is good and what is not, and what is error and what is not. But like from your study, like what would you give, like what are your advices or suggestions to, like, which can help improve these models?
I think one of the key things that's missing from computer graphics research relative to human research. And this makes perfect sense because it's not related to your goal, is the concept of task. Because in graphics, you're dealing mainly with the what we would call the stimulus. So you care about the image. And it's very tempting to say, well, how similar are these two images? Well, I mean, we can compute that in an L2 norm or something like this, or you come up with some fancy image comparison metric, but that's not what it's like for a human who's trying to compare two images. Because the human almost always has a specific task, and depending on the task, they will draw on very different components of that image to perform the task, right? So it's very difficult to define a metric until you define what task it is that the human is meant to be performing. And so that's why you will get a difference between, for example, just noise detection metrics or image similarity metrics or conceptual similarity metrics or performance metrics. Right. Are these two things similar to grasp?
Yeah. Exactly.
And so you have to start thinking about those things. I think that is why there's still a big gulf between the little that we know from the human point of view and the kind of what can be automated so far using image analyses. I hope that's
right. Yeah. I think it does. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Sure.
So we have a question about binocular vision and how that can also play on material perception.
It does, yes. It does have an impact. There are studies that have shown that, for example, particularly with glossy surfaces, specular reflections behave in this interesting way in binocular terms because of parallax, basically. You end up with virtual images which are offset from the surface in terms of their disparities. And if you render a surface with so that monocularly in a single image, it looks identical to a regular mirrored surface, but you kind of stick the patterns onto the surface in binocular depth, then you lose the impression of gloss. So, and in fact, we have a study, we have a couple of studies on that. So there's a paper in Proceedings of the Royal Society on that, where we show that by sticking patterns on surfaces, they look matte. So binocular disparity does have a big impact, but on the other hand, I don't want to overemphasize its role for several reasons. First of all, it actually turns out that a significant proportion of the population does not have binocular vision. In fact, it's more common than what is called color blindness. So as many as 1 in 5 people have defective or absent binocular vision, and yet they never report, oh, I can't tell the difference between glossy and matte things or something like this. So it's a cue, but it's not the dominant cue.
So actually, I had a question, so I will ask it. Sure. So in the last part of your talk, you show how you use this autoencoder and that the outcome actually matches human mistakes as well. And that relates to some of our goals in graphics. We mostly care about generating plausible images that's plausible by humans, not to really perform on a particular task from a computer vision perspective. So there are many models that have been proposed. Some of the most successful are generative adversarial networks. I was wondering, as you started this research, if you consider different architectures or losses or mechanisms, and if you had an opinion about which ones are closest to your goal of understanding human perception.
It's a fascinating question. I mean, I think that as a psychologist and neuroscientist, in the long term, the promise or the goal with deep learning is to be able to have a model that kind of corresponds in some meaningful anatomical way onto the brain structures. So then the issue of architecture is no longer just does it do a better job of fulfilling its objective function, but it's like, is it biologically plausible? Does it have the correct number of units relative to different brain areas? Are the connectivities feasible? Is the learning objective feasible? So that's where we want to get to in the long run. I'm not using deep neural networks that way just yet. At the moment, I'm just using them to test high-level questions or hypotheses about how learning could proceed in the first place. So for me, actually, I've found that varying architecture has not been as fruitful as varying learning objective. So that learning objective and training set is what really, really has a massive impact on the nature of the internal representations. You can, for example, take a conventional convnet and vary the depth by a lot, and you will find that somewhere in the neural network is something that resembles what humans do. If it's three layers or 300 layers, you're still going to get some kind of correspondence somewhere. So that's the main thing that we've been focusing on. We have played about with other things. We use GANs a lot in my group. This one we used a pixel VAE. It just turned out to work pretty well. Transformers are really interesting as well, right? But they're getting kind of even further and further away from the way that we can think about biological vision. So I think I'm focusing on objective functions at the moment.
Thank you. And in a sense, the discriminator acts as a objective function. Another question about translucency. I know that you studied those as well, so maybe you can comment. Which network model you recommend to understand translucency in materials?
Well, I haven't tried doing it yet. Yes, I mean it's a fascinating question. I would hope that the same kind of objectives that work with reflectance should also work with translucency. The fact that the physics are very different, that in one case you're dealing only with surface and in another case you're dealing with subsurface scatter, makes it sound like you might need a different architecture. But I would hope that in both cases, they manifest their physical characteristics as detectable statistical changes in the pixels. And if that's true, then you should be able to use pixel VAEs or GANs or some kind of unsupervised learning architecture to separate out different characteristics of translucency as well.
Mm-hmm. So one more question here. Face images have a variety of attributes we need to look at, lighting, face shape, emotion. How can we measure the perception of these very different attributes?
So how can we measure them perceptually in perceptual experiments?
I guess so. Maybe if Victor
yeah,
wants
I mean,
to.
Yeah. In its simplest form, the dumbest kind of experiment that you can do is you show someone an image and you say, rate how much it looks blah, right? So how happy does it look, you know, and things like this. That is actually something that works quite well if you do it with multiple dimensions. So you have a single image and, for example, 10 or 15 sliders that you've got to move and you've got to rate each of these things. I find that you can actually, you can learn a lot. You can represent different stimuli in multidimensional spaces in much the same way as the neural networks are representing them in multidimensional spaces. And you can read out from the pattern of responses how different factors have larger or smaller impacts on people's perception. So that is the main approach that we've used. Of course, some people are a bit more rigorous and they do things with detection tasks and discrimination tasks and things like this. But I think that if you really care about appearance, it's good to avoid discrimination and detection because that tends to fixate the viewer on the details of the proximal stimulus. And what you really care about in appearance is, do things look similar? Does this look more fluffy than this thing? Does it look happier than this thing? So that's where we use ratings and similarity mm-hmm. judgments.
And there was another part in the question, using assembled coding, we can measure the average of one of the attributes, but can you tell if it is correct to isolate one of the attributes, even if there are many others? So I guess it's related to these entanglements.
Right. I mean, there are statistical tests that you can perform to try to work out whether the attributes are independent from one another. So that's the main challenge, is basically what you should do is things like factor analysis. Those are statistical techniques. I mean, it's basically factor analysis, is just a fancy word for PCA, but there are more sophisticated ways that you can do this as well. But if you do things like partial correlations, then you can work out whether you've actually got orthogonal factors that you can assess independently.
Thank you. I think we have one last question. I don't know if Ekin Osturk wants to ask the question live. So that'll go. So considering that these neural networks are like isolated visual systems, how do you think the neural network encodings are influenced by the lack of human self-recognition and the ability to relate other senses to visual stimuli?
Yeah, great, great question. I mean, so this is like, that's like a 17th century philosophy question. That's a classic research question for the whole field that people have struggled with a lot. Lots of people believe that interaction with the world, so what's called embodied perception, is very important. And there are certain kinds of aspects of vision for which it is clearly very important. If you want to learn about sensory motor mapping, so learning relationships between perception and action, of course you need to interact with the world. But for what's called mid-level vision, so surface perception, I'm actually pretty skeptical that you need to have embodied vision in order to be able to learn to see this stuff. we've kind of got a proof of principle already with what we've demonstrated here. There's no interaction signals. And if you think about, for example, the case of congenital tetraplegics, so people who are born unable to move, they get much less interaction with the world. They have essentially no visual deficits. So that also pretty strongly indicates that you can learn just passively in terms of vision. Of course, cross-referencing across the sensors is another very important source of information, and we're trying to do research on neural networks that do that right at the moment. So next year I can give you an answer.
Thank you. Well, this ends the questions, and it also ends with a big challenge that you're trying to solve, so it gives food for thought. Thank you again, Roland. I guess we can go for a round of applause. And, we'll...
Thank you very much, guys. Really appreciate it.
And I'll just do one announcement. We would like to give a Best Presentation Award this year. So you all attendees must have received an email with some instructions on how we will do that. So please check your mailbox and look back at the talks you've seen so far and try to take notes of the ones that will deserve the prize. So thank you again. Goodbye.
Thanks. Bye.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the High Performance Rendering session at EGSR 2021. My name is Philip Sluzalek, and of course, as you might know, this is a session that is very close to my heart, to the research we've been doing for many years. And we have a selection of really great papers today. That we'll be looking at. And so without further ado, let's dive right into the session. The first paper is by the Technical University of Vienna, by Markus Schütz, Bernhard Kerbel, and Michael Wimmer, as you like. The title of the paper is Rendering Point Clouds with Computed and Vertex Order Optimization. And they show very nicely in a minute how actually doing things in computators can dramatically outperform the graphics pipeline, which I think is a very interesting direction to look into. And so I'm very excited about this. So we can directly start into the presentation.
Hey, everyone. Thanks for joining the session today. What I'd like to talk to, about today is about the rendering about, of point clouds with computers. And what you're trying to do is to render a large amount of points in real time. So to the right here, we have 700 million points. We'd like to be able to render this brute force every frame in real time. So essentially, we're trying to provide an alternative to gldraw arrays using the glpoints primitive, because as far as we can tell, glpoints primitive, it kind of builds on the triangle rasterization pipeline. So it makes a lot of assumptions that are not necessarily true and optimal for point cloud rendering. So with computators, we can only do the amount of work that we really need to do for point clouds. And by doing that, we can be about 10 times faster than the hardware pipeline. So the peak performance that we observed is that we could render up to 50 billion points per second. And this translates to a memory usage of about 800 gigabytes per second, which means we can render about 800 million points at a frame rate of 60 frames per second. We also found out that the vertex order strongly affects the rendering times, but not because of the reading of the vertices like you'd know from triangle rendering, but because of the order in which you write the points to the frame buffer. So this is how our method works, or the most basic variation of it. First, we have a computer where we encode the depth and the color component into a single 64-bit integer. And we then use atomic min to store the closest point in each pixel into a custom frame buffer. And in the second pass, we then read the colors in this kind of interleaved depth and color buffer and store the color into an OpenGL texture. So this kind of image is what we can get out of that. It's pretty much equivalent to rendering a point cloud with glpoints. But with glpoints, it takes about 30 milliseconds to render this frame, and with atomic min, it only needs about 5 milliseconds for a point cloud of 140 million points. There are still some things we can address to further speed up the performance, and one of them is that there's a massive amount of overdraw in point clouds. So, for example, if we have a point cloud with 720 million points and we project that to just 2 million pixels, then we're going to end up with a whole lot of pixels with thousands to even tens of thousands of points. So these pink points here, those are points where there are more than 10,000 pixels inside. So in order to reduce the amount of atomic min operations that are rather costly, we can implement some kind of early depth test, where before we're trying to call atomic min on a certain pixel location, we first read an already written point at that pixel. And if the new point is closer than the old point, only then do we need to call atomic min. And if this is not the case, we can simply discard a point because atomic min won't do anything. And with this optimization, so this is the same point cloud as before, we can get huge performance improvements again. So it was the point cloud from before. And this is the same point cloud from a different viewpoint. And just by changing the viewpoint, glpoints got 5 times lower, atomic min got 4 times lower. But atomic min combined with this early depth test still performs very well with just 5 milliseconds compared to the 150 milliseconds from glpoints. So in this case, we are already 50 times faster than the hardware pipeline. Although admittedly, this is a very extreme case. So this is not always the case, but it's usually about 10 times at least. So there are ways to further improve the amount of atomic min calls that we have to do. And what we can do, for example, is to exploit subgroup communication. So in a subgroup, the threads can communicate very efficiently with each other. And we can check if the whole subgroup writes to a single pixel. And if this is the case, then we don't need to do 32, for example, atomic min calls for each thread. Instead, we can just do one single atomic min call. So we just find the thread that has the closest point, and only this thread is going to call atomic min. The only problem with that approach is that it works very well when you're zoomed out, but when you're close up, it's not very likely that 32 points project to the same pixel. So if this fails, what we can still do is we can try to check pairs of threads. If two threads write to the same pixel, and if this is the case, then only one of those two threads needs to do the atomic call. The fastest approach here is by using some kind of complete deduplication, where we can reduce the amount of atomic mins to the amount of affected pixels. So if 32 threads are trying to write to 3 pixels, then we're only going to do 3 atomic min calls. And this is typically the fastest approach, but it also requires some relatively new hardware features. So it might not work on all hardware, on older hardware. So depending on the hardware you have available, you can either use reduce approach or use the DDAP approach. Apart from making things faster, we can also try to make things look a bit nicer. Because this GL points approach and introduced atomic approaches, they result in rather aliased renderings, like on the left here. And this is pretty much the same as rendering a textured mesh without any kind of texture filtering. So with high quality shading, what we're trying to do is to not just get a color value from one point in a pixel, but instead we compute the average of multiple points in a pixel. And the way this works is we implement a free pass approach that's already known from high quality splatting, but splatting does, it renders oriented splats with a larger point size. We only render a single point per pixel, so it's a bit simplified. And the free passes that we use here is one geometry pass where we first create a depth map that is shifted slightly behind, so 1% further away. And in the second pass, we sum up the colors of all points that pass this depth test. So not just the closest point, but also points that are slightly behind the closest point. And in the third pass, we then use this average, the sum value to compute the average, and then store the average into an OpenGL texture. And you can see on the bottom right here, the performance result for the high quality splatting, so that the two right ones are for high quality splatting and an improved version of it. And they are about 2 to 4 times lower than the fastest compute approaches, but you can also see that they're an order of magnitude faster than GL points. And again, this is a bit of an extreme case here, but this is a normal point cloud with a normal viewpoint, so this is something that you can encounter every day when you work with point clouds. And the vertex order also matters a lot when you're writing to the frame buffers and not reading. And usually it's good if you have a little bit of locality, like you have 32 threads that try to run to the same pixel, that can be good. If you have 10,000 threads trying to simultaneously write to one pixel, then we have a bit of a problem. So this can cause slowdowns up to 5 times or even up to 10 times. So we'd like to avoid that. Some typical orderings of points that you might encounter or might be able to create yourself is a Morton ordered point cloud, where if you render a close-up view, Morton order is really nice because you have good locality of consecutively stored points. But when you zoom out of the point cloud, you get excessive locality because now you have 1,000 point or 10,000 points writing to a single pixel simultaneously. With shuffled datasets, on the other hand, we have no locality. So in close-up views, we don't benefit from locality. But on the other hand, when we're zooming out, we also don't suffer from excessive locality. And based on this observation, we kind of suggest using some kind of shuffled Morton order, which preserves the advantages of both approaches. And this shuffled Morton order looks like this here. We have an arbitrarily ordered input point cloud, and then we first sort it by Morton order. And then we group this point cloud into batches of about 128 points, and then we shuffle or rearrange those batches. And what we end up with is that within a batch, the points still have good locality, which we can exploit. But between the batches, so from one batch to another, we have no locality. So we are avoiding excessive locality while rendering to pixels. And here are some performance results, now for GL points, not for compute. So GL points is the one that benefits the most from this ordering. And to the left, you can see a point cloud where Morton order takes 150 milliseconds to render this image here. And just by shuffling, we almost get a 4x speed improvement. And the shuffled Morton order, on the other hand, is faster than either of those two orderings. On the right, we see a close-up of another point cloud where Morton order is a bit faster than the shuffled one. And original order is faster than both Morton and shuffled. So neither of these artificially generated ones might be the best one. The shuffled Morton order, on the other hand, is better than all of these other orderings that we evaluated. So generally, it performs very well. It's either always the fastest or within close margins of the fastest. So we can highly recommend using it. Here's another example too from peak performance result. where we don't use shuffled Morton order, but regular Morton order, because regular Morton order, it works very well in combination with the computator DTAP approach and early C. And in this case, we're rendering 800 millions or almost 800 million points with a frame rate of 60 to 64 frames per second, and no matter the viewpoint. So you can move around this point cloud, you can zoom out very far, close up, you can completely move the point cloud outside of the view frustum. You're pretty much always between 60 to 64 frames per second. So being relatively viewpoint independent is kind of a nice property because it makes the performance very predictable, and at the same time, it's also the fastest approach we have here. Of course, there are also some limitations to our approach, and one of them is actually a limitation of our paper. We only evaluated for NVIDIA GPUs because we didn't have AMD ones available, but we can at least refer to one prior work here where they also did a compute approach that does a busy loop to write the points, and they had some good experience with AMD, so here's hoping that our approach would also work well there. Another limitation is that we only rendered points with one pixel size, so we don't have larger point sprites. And our approach needs 64-bit integer atomics, which are not available everywhere. There's also a bit of a dispatch call overhead, so for very small point clouds, this probably isn't very useful. But it's very useful for if you have a lot of overdraws, so when you have tens of millions of points and they cluster to a few pixels, then this is very useful. So in conclusion, I'd like to say that computators, they are very useful for larger point clouds, often about 10 times, sometimes up to 50 times faster. Morton order, it can be the slowest, especially for GL points, and at the same time, it can also be the fastest ordering when combined with the DDUP and LEC methods. Shuffled Morton order is often the fastest one, especially for GL points, and if it's not the fastest one, it's close to the fastest one, so it's always a good choice to use it. And with that, I'd like to say thank you for attention. And if you're interested in the source code, please check out this GitHub repository. Thank you.
Excellent. Excellent results, impressive results. Who would have thought that avoiding the hardware actually speeds things up? That usually is the other way around. We don't have any questions here, written questions yet. Oh, there's the first one just coming in. Also feel free and feel encouraged to ask your question by audio. So that's a little bit more interactive in this virtual environment here. Yeah, we also take written questions. Could the same idea be applied to mesh shaders, which I would like to generalize a little bit. That was would have been my question here. What are the properties that you have, you kind of alluded to that, but what are the properties and how much do you think you can generalize this to other tasks, right? So where do you see the difference or the border between this works well on the compute shader and this is where you need the hardware support?
Yeah, regarding the mesh shaders, it's a bit of a tough question for me because I never used them. But I can only refer to this new nanite system from Unreal Engine, where they're also using these kind of atomics and compute rasterization for small triangles. And they have a speed up of about, on average, 3 times faster than the hardware for small triangles. So kind of like our points that are just 1 pixel big. And the large triangles, for that, they're still using the hardware pipeline. And regarding generalization, not sure about that. So this is very tightly for small point clouds. And we briefly tried it for larger points, for example. But that didn't scale very well. It didn't scale as good as GL points, because GL points is it's doing triangle rasterization. Triangle rasterization is good for larger triangles, so that scales better for larger points. And for other general stuff, I guess nanite has also shown that it works good with triangles.
Mm. So it's essentially that locality and this almost one-to-one mapping between the thing you want to be drawing. So it's essentially you'll deal with a single pixel at a time.
Yeah.
Is that kind of the conclusion?
Kind of, yeah.
Yeah. There's another question. Could it be beneficial to pre-construct a pre-filtered point hierarchy for the minification case? Asked by Nettie.
Oh, yes, absolutely. So especially performance-wise, this would be a great benefit. It's actually what we're going to work on now. Because one of the problems for minification performance-wise is that this approach is bound by memory bandwidth. So this is not going to be faster by rendering the same amount of points. It can only be faster by rendering fewer points because we still need to render to load all these points from vertex buffer. Regarding the quality, probably not so much quality improvements, since if we're doing this minification, we're just computing the average of even more points. We're computing the average of all relevant points.
Mm-hmm. Very nice. Another question, could you make use of other hardware units like the texturing pipeline or other things? Have you tried that? Or how would that interfere maybe with your approach?
We really haven't tried that, so I can't really tell about give any guess about that, unfortunately.
Well, I mean, the reason I fully understand that, first of all, but the reason I'm asking is, right, there is this idea of inverting the rendering pipeline, right? And currently you have the fixed function pipeline, and then you're programming different stages within that. There could be the other way around, and it would have been interesting if you had some ideas in that direction. I guess we have to move on. Great paper. Thank you very much. Yes, we'll go to the next paper. So first of all, we should have a big round of applause, virtual applause here, of course. Unfortunately, only that. And we're going to the next paper, which is Moving Basis Decomposition for Precomputed Light Transport by Ari Silvenneunen, or whatever the best pronunciation for that is, and Peter Pike Sloan. Both are from Activision, of course. And this is about finding an efficient representation of for precomputed light transport in order to render that quickly, and it's being used in AAA games or to be applied there. So really interesting stuff, really from the trenches of really creating productions. With that, let's start the presentation.
Hi, my name is Ari. I'm a fellow software engineer at Activision, and today I'm going to present moving basis decomposition for precomputed light transport. So this talk is about global illumination in the context of real-time games, and I wanted to start by highlighting some of the scalability challenges we have faced during the development of our recent titles. First of all, in order to render large maps at 60 frames per second across multiple hardware generations, our engine relies on precomputed lighting techniques. However, at the same time, we want to keep our download sizes small, which creates a conflict with increasing scene sizes. For example, let's consider this single-player campaign map from Black Ops Cold War. If we disable the material textures, we can see the lighting better. And if we disable direct sunlight, we are left with precomputed lighting only. And as you can see, it plays a big part in this scene. And if we think about the memory usage for this map, we find that just a simple irradiance volume takes already 1.5 gigabytes of data, and this is just linear SH RGB encoding. Storing the lighting in this form is clearly not feasible, so we need to compress this data so it fits in the available memory budget. And this talk is mostly about solving this compression problem. The good news is that we're not the first ones to consider this compression problem, and there's a lot of related work that we can study and learn from. Let's start with linear dimensionality reduction methods. So in this setting, we have some high dimensional target data. And our goal is to approximate the target data by a linear combination of basis vectors. The basis vectors live in the same potentially high dimensional space, while the basis coefficients, they are just scalars. And for the approximation to make sense, we want a small reconstruction error, and the number of components in the approximation should be small, at least relative to the dimension of the domain where the data lives. A common problem with all these methods stems from the fact that they assume independent clusters. To see why this is a problem, let's take a look at a simple example where our target data is a smooth vector field and lives in R3. Blockwise PCA assumes that the target signal is spatially coherent, and then it goes ahead and splits the domain into fixed size blocks and computes a one-dimensional PCA approximation for each block. On the other hand, clustered PCA does not really care about spatial coherence, at least explicitly, but instead assigns each data vector to the closest cluster while building a PCA basis per cluster. In this case, both methods have been given a budget of 9 clusters, and you can clearly see the discontinuities between the clusters. The main issue here is that clusters are independent. This means that the reconstruction model does not allow for interactions between the clusters. And that's why you can clearly see the cluster boundary artifacts here and here. So this cluster discontinuity problem is not unique to the linear dimensionality reduction methods. And it turns out that this is kind of a fundamental issue in a wide range of related dimensionality reduction methods. And we discussed this more in the paper. None of the previous methods take continuous reconstruction into account, and this motivates our key idea of incorporating spatial coherence and continuous reconstruction into the model from first principles. Next, we are going to go over our method with more detail. The starting point is the same as before. So we have some high dimensional data and we seek a linear combination that approximates this data. However, the key step in our formulation is assuming that the data visualized here is a piecewise smooth function over some low dimensional domain like 2D or 3D. And now we take the basis expansion here and write both the coefficients and the basis vectors as a function of the spatial domain. So if we look at the reconstruction formula right now, we see that this form doesn't really allow us to compute anything yet. So the next step is to write each term in this sum as a product of two kernel expansions. So we have a kernel expansion for the coefficients and a kernel expansion for the basis vectors. And here the kernel functions are simply scalar functions on the spatial domain. As an example, we can visualize some of the basis kernel functions over here. These are just linear hat functions. And I've visualized some coefficient kernels over here. And there's a couple of key points here. One is that the basis kernel functions, they overlap, and this overlap allows them to share information during the reconstruction. That's the key to make the reconstruction seamless. And on the other hand, we see that each basis vector that is supported by this basis kernel overlaps a lot of coefficients. And this is the other key property that allows us to have compression. So to summarize, we can define the moving basis decomposition as a tuple where we have two sequences of kernels and their corresponding coefficients. So let's take a look at the simple example. Now, in this example, the data lives in a spatial domain in the interval between 0 and 1. For the coefficient kernels, we're just going to use the linear hat functions that are centered at 0 and at 1. And we use the same kernels for the basis vectors as well. Now, in this case, we can explicitly write what is the moving basis decomposition. So in this case, we have two sequences of kernels, and then we have the coefficient tensors, or in this case, they're just vectors. Now, if we write out or expand the coefficient function and the basis function, and plug those in to our reconstruction formula, we can see that with two linear kernels, we actually end up with a quadratic model. So clearly, this is a nonlinear model, and thus it's more expressible than just linear basis decompositions. So given some piecewise smooth target function and a set of fixed kernels that we have chosen that suit our problem, the way we obtain the MBD is to solve this global optimization problem. And we are minimizing this energy, and the energy is just the reconstruction error over the full spatial domain. So the integral is over the spatial domain, and at each point we want the reconstruction to be close to the target function. And the closeness is measured in terms of the squared norm. Okay. Now the problem is a global optimization problem. It's non-linear. In fact, it's biconvex, but it has a really sparse structure. And the sparsity comes from the fact that if we choose kernel with compact support, the interactions are limited to a small neighborhood around each kernel. And this is helpful when we are trying to actually numerically solve the problem. To solve the optimization problem, we use a quasi-Newton solver with diagonal Hessian approximation. And you can find the details in the paper. The important bit here is that the solver scales reliably for very large problems. For example, our production scenes have routinely over 100 million unknown parameters, and it usually only takes a few minutes to solve the MBD problem. Now it's time to look at some results. Let's start by revisiting the cluster discontinuity problem from before. In this case, MBD produces almost exactly the reference image, while clustered PCA and blockwise PCA suffer from the cluster discontinuities. Furthermore, if we cut the number of clusters by half, we can still obtain nearly flawless results. And here you can see what happens for CPCA and blockwise PCA. In addition, we see that MPD converges in terms of relative MSC, and it achieves the lowest MSC among the comparison methods. Here's another toy example where the input data is simply an RGB image and the output is compressed using really large 64 by 64 pixel blocks. They're roughly the size of these windows here. And we use two basis vectors per block. And we compare block PCA against MPD. And the point here is to show that the hard block boundaries with blockwise PCA are smoothed out by the moving basis decomposition, since the blocks or clusters are allowed to coordinate during the reconstruction. And this happens because the basis kernels overlap, as well as the coefficient kernels do. The main application is compression of precomputed lighting data. And in this case, we stack the direct light transport and indirect light transport operators into a single high-dimensional vector. And we compare against blockwise PCA, window PCA, and cluster PCA. The first test shows direct light transport results, and we can see that MPD, shown here, doesn't suffer from the cluster discontinuity artifacts, and also it has lower error as the number of basis vectors increases. The next test shows indirect lighting results, and the story is similar to the direct lighting results. Again, we don't see any boundary artifacts with MBD, and overall the error is lower as the number of basis vectors varies. Finally, we can revisit the example from before, and this time using MBD, we are able to compress the 1.5 gigabytes down to 37 megabytes of data. And the nice thing about this application is that the basis kernels are actually 2D functions, while the coefficient kernels are 3D. And this showcases the flexibility and power of the moving basis decomposition framework. To summarize, we presented a new moving basis decomposition method that generalizes many existing methods, and I think this machinery might be useful in other problem domains with similar characteristics, such as natural image processing. And with that, I will conclude my talk. Thank you for your attention.
Great, thank you very much. That's an impressive compression that you've shown there. Just a few megabytes from what was a 1.5 gigabyte, if I remember correctly. So please, if you have any questions, add them here on the left, or actually, there we have an interactive question. That's great. Please go ahead. You're still muted, and the video is still there. Do you want to ask a question? Please go ahead. Excellent. Hi.
Hi. Impressive work. How does this, you know, you're talking about light transport, and you showed that big GB model. Where else, what other models have you tried these kind of things on? I mean, on games, or where is this really applicable for the killer application?
Oh, so the motivating application was video games. So this has been used in multiple Activision titles, mostly in the big Warzone game modes. So the motivating application was compression of pre-computed lighting data for video games. And this is actually what we ship with on all hardware platforms currently.
So this is in shipping games, is that
correct? Yes, that's correct. Yeah.
Great. Do you only use it for pre-computed light transport? It seems that this could be applicable to a whole range of other things as well.
It could be, yes. So currently it's been used to drive the pre-computed light transport application. But yeah, I would assume that if you have certain data that shares the same characteristics, so the data needs to be spatially coherent or locally linear, then I think this type of moving basis decomposition fits well.
Right.
And I believe it would. So the interesting thing here is that you can actually lower the error when you compare to blockwise PCA or CPCA, because the local coherence is taken into account when we interpolate the basis vectors. So locally, you get kind of better fit to the data that way. But if you have just like a random collection of random data, then this might not be the method of choice.
Well, in graphics, most things are not random, and so that seems. So, have you explored it? But do you want to ask another question?
No, I'm done.
Okay, great, perfect. Sorry, now I lost my question. Anyway, the one thing that wasn't clear to me is you didn't really visualize the different basis functions and how you applied them for this specific application. Also, like for your toy example, can you maybe describe how you did actually apply those and how did you choose these basis functions? Are they all on a fixed grid? I mean, I think you could even think about doing this adaptively. Did you do that? I wasn't sure about that.
Yeah, that's a really good question. So the choice of the basis function in this case was driven by GPU friendliness. So in this case, we use linear basis functions. But the interesting thing is that the basis kernels for the basis vectors themselves, they live in on a 2D domain, kind of on top of the height field of the scene. And then the coefficients themselves, they live in fully 3D volume. So you can reconstruct the irradiance at every point in the scene. But the good observation that you had there is that you can actually mix and match these kernels quite freely. So the solver and the solver doesn't really change if you suddenly choose to use larger basis kernels at some point in the scene and smaller basis kernels at some point in the scene. Or even basis kernels from different families. Say you want to mix exponentials with linear hats. That's totally fine. It's just what you're basically, the trade-off there is that it's kind of an assumption that depending on the application, you know what fits the application domain well. In our case, we wanted to utilize hardware accelerated texture lookup, so hat basis kernels were kind of a natural choice in that setting.
We're almost running out of time, but there is a question that I want to address. The error didn't seem to reduce monotonically as the number of basis coefficient increases. What's the explanation for that? Is it related to local support simplicity of the basis function?
Oh, that's a good question. So I think one of the things here, if you look at the graphs, so you kind of see this monotonic behavior at first. Then once you get to a quite high number of basis vectors, say over 10 or so, at that point, the solver, because we are using a stochastic quasi-Newton descent, I think at that point, the solver error itself starts to fluctuate. And in relative terms, the error is already really, really low. So we are at, basically, we are plateauing at the local minima, and then we have some slight fluctuation around that local minima. And I think that's a characteristic of the solver, and mostly the strict non-monotonicity. But if you look at, if you kind of increase the basis vectors even more and zoom out the graph, kind of change the scale, you can see that it actually goes down monotonically. So it increases and kind of converges in the end. But yeah, that's a good question.
Excellent. Thanks, Stephen Hill, for that. And with that, we're running out of time. Thank you very much, Ari, for your talk and the great answers. And we'll move on to the next paper in our session, which is called Fast Polygonal Splatting Using Directional Kernel Differences by, and now excuse if I get the names not perfectly right, Juji Moroto, Toshiya Hachizuka, of course, and Nobuyuki Umetani. They are from, where is my paper? They are from the University of Tokyo and the University of Waterloo. And it's about the nasty problem of computing depth of field filtering with these nasty large kernels and how this can be accelerated to higher performance. And with that, I hand over to the presentations.
Hello everyone, I'm Yuji Moroto. Today I present a method for fast polygonal splatting using the directional kernel difference. First, let me introduce a bokeh. Images taken by a camera have a limited range of focus. It is said that DOF is shallow if the range of focus is narrow. By blurring the background and focusing only on the subject, we can guide the viewer's gaze. In this video, by manipulating the focus, viewer's gaze is guided to the ninja or shuriken. The kernels of blur are mainly divided into two types. One is lens bokeh, which is closer to the lens of the camera. The other is Gaussian blur that can be computed at high speed using approximations. Lens bokeh is preferred for production, but is much slower. These are images showing the difference between each type of blur. In movie production, lens blur is often preferred because the highlights are beautiful. In particular, a kernel close to a circle is preferred. Our target is an ideal flat polygonal kernel. The actual bokeh of a camera lens has a complex kernel, but lens maker try to make the bokeh as flat as possible. Also, the bokeh used in video editing software is mainly flat. We present a fast computation method for such a flat polygonal kernel. The computation of DO filter, where the kernel size vary with respect to the depths, has been difficult. The DOF filter is computed by convoluting each pixel in a different kernel. A small kernel is splatted in the focus area, and large kernel is splatted in the out-of-focus area. In related work, there is a method speeding up the kernel by differentiating. First, they difference the kernel on the x and y axis. Then we get a sparse kernel. The convolution of kernels with few non-zero elements can be computed naively fast. Now we get a differential image. Finally, we can get the resulting image by reconstructing it. The method using Laplacian kernel splatting focuses on the sparse nature of the kernels in the Laplacian domain. This method uses the convolution pyramids method to solve the Poisson equation approximately for fast reconstruction from a Laplacian domain. But it doesn't give an accurate result. Our method doesn't invoke approximation, so we can make accurate computations. Then let me introduce our approach. First, we compute the difference in the y-axis. After that, we divide this difference kernel by the directional components of the edge. Then, for each buffers, we compute the difference. For example, in the x-axis buffer, we compute the horizontal difference, and the other diagonal components, we take the diagonal difference. This will give us a difference kernel with only on the corners of the original kernel remaining. The size of this kernel is always only 12 points for an octagon, regardless of the original radius. Then we split the kernels into buffers in each directional difference. First, we get reference image that is splattered by the kernel. Then we sum it horizontally. Other kernels are also summed in the diagonal direction. And then we merge them. This is integrated on the y-axis to produce the resulting image. The following is a summary of our present method. In the previous method, the differentiation is performed continuously. In our method, after differentiating the y-axis, we split it into several kernels to make it easier to differentiate in each direction. This reduces the increase in the number of non-zero values. In this way, we succeed in reducing a simple polygon to a fixed number of kernels regardless of the radius. Our method can be useful for a simple slope that can be expressed with a ratio of small integers, but the slope with a complex ratio requires more points, making the splitting slower. Furthermore, polygons with a very large number of edges requires a lot of computation. In some cases, a special shape of bokeh is useful for dramatic purposes. For example, in this bridal video, the bokeh is shaped like hearts. Such special shapes cannot be handled naively by our method, so we also present method to rectify the input polygon to the polygons our method can handle. First, we give an overview of the transformation method. As input, we specify the kernel of the raster, the set of edges to use, and the number of edges to approximate. Based on this input, the polygon with the smallest area difference among the polygons that include the input is output. The blue line shows the resulting polygon. This output kernel can be represented by only a simple slope edge, which makes DOF filtering possible with our method. The heart example is too complicated, so we will use a simple pentagon in the next section. We will approximate this pentagon to a polygon with 4 sides at most using only 4 different slopes. The important point is that the edges of output polygon must be tangent to the input shape. First, list all the edges that can be tangent to the input polygon. For example, it looks like this. We then choose two of these edges and take the area of the difference between them and the input kernel as the cost. For example, the area where vertex 1a intersects vertex 2d looks like this. These edges are constructed as an intersection graph. The intersection of these two edges is represented as a single edge going from 1a to 2d in the graph on the right. On this graph, consider a single closed path. For example, the path with 2c, 4a, and 1b draws a triangle in the original kernel. If we find the one with the lowest cost among these crossed paths, we can get the polygon with the lowest error. This can be computed efficiently by using dynamic programming. By using directional differentiation of each edge of the resulting polygon, we can achieve a differential kernel that can be used in our method. Next is the experiment and its result. First, here is a graph of increase the radius of the DOF with fixed image size. The brute force method produces a parabolic graph with respect to the radius. The Thomas-Laplacian method produces a graph that is linear with respect to the radius. This is order nr. On the other hand, the computation time of our present method increases little as the radius increases. This is order n. Our method is 11 to 24 times faster than the Laplacian method at radius of 200. The next is the result of the DOF filter. This is a scene of flowers with shooting stars. Since the brightness of the star is high, we can see the shape of the octagon in the bokeh. Also, we can see how the flowers gradually become blurred as they move backward. This is the result of zooming in on one frame of the result. It's good basically in both the in-focus and out-of-focus areas. We can see an octagonal bokeh in the highlights. However, it has the same occlusion problem as the brute force method. The front blur at the back where it overlaps the flower petal has disappeared. To solve this problem, we need filter in several layers. Next, we compare the output of our method with the Laplacian method by Thomas and his colleagues. Our method doesn't use approximation so that there is no error. In the meanwhile, Laplacian method uses approximation for the reconstruction, so it is subject to large errors. Next, here is the time it takes to get the difference kernel and the result. It took only a few seconds to get the best approximation. However, there are sometimes cases where asymmetric results are obtained depending on n. Here are examples of the clover and pentagram. The clover is a very complex shape, but it could be traced correctly with a large number of vertex. Finally, the axial filtering result. These are 12 vertex hearts, but the results are natural also they are approximation with few edges. Next is the results for clovers. When the bokeh is small, there is not much difference between the two. Please let me summarize. We present a method to differentiating and splat the kernel in many directions. Typically, order n log n or order n r is required to compute lens blur. Our method achieves an order of magnitude faster speed for the DO filter computation in order n. In addition, our filtering method doesn't involve any approximation and hence very accurate. Because our method only supports polygon with edges with a simple integer ratio, we also present a method to rectify user input polygon with minimum error. This makes it possible to use our method with various kernels. We introduce the limitations and future work of our present methods. First of all, the unique problem of this method is that we can only hand flat and polygonal polygons. Real camera lenses are also developed with flat bokeh as an ideal, so this will not be a problem for most use cases, but we will try to handle non-flat kernels in future work. Also, since the metric for this auto-approximation algorithm only uses the difference in the area, a better metric that takes into account symmetry and other factors would be interesting. Thank you for listening.
Oops, we seem to be missing the last sentence or so, but I think we got everything important. Thank you very much for this nice paper, and it's a nice way to speed up the computation for this computer application, and that's really quite nice. I wasn't sure whether you do anything. So first of all, please ask questions either by in text or by audio. Feel free to do that. So my question to start off. Do you do anything special to handle occlusion, right? I mean, if your filter is centered on an object that's in the back, you typically don't want to filter over the stuff that's actually in the front. Do you do anything special, or is just the standard method? I wasn't clear from your presentation.
Sorry, I couldn't hear your question. Repeat, please.
You talked briefly about the occlusion problem, right? Which is if your filter is centered on an object that's far, let's say far away, you don't necessarily want to filter over an object that is closer by, even though your kernel would actually overlap with that. You mentioned briefly that you do something there, but it wasn't clear what you're doing.
If we use the SWAT method of DOF, we will get the correct quality of output without additional processing, because SWAT method is to correct because almost correct is right behavior with in real lens. But there is occlusion problem. There is it has occlusion problem. So solve occlusion problem to divide several layers to blurring it and last merging it. Did okay. I answer your question?
I'm not sure I fully understood this, but I think we have to move on. Thank you very much for your presentation, and we should give you also a nice round of applause, which I forgot to ask for the last paper. So thank you very much. Thank you. And we're moving on to the next paper, which is Fast Analytic Soft Shadows from Area Light Sources. Unfortunately, I don't have the full names here. It's Akash KT, Parikshit Zakurika, and PJ Narayana. Hopefully I didn't mangle your names too much. And again, it's about a very interesting topic of how to analytically compute the soft shadow, or analytically integrate with the soft shadow with a very interesting technique that I guess we'll hear more about now in this presentation. So please go ahead.
Okay, I hope my screen is visible. Hi, I'm Akash. I'm a PhD student at IIIT Hyderabad, and today I'm going to be presenting our work, Fast Analytic Soft Shadows from Area Lights, a joint work with my advisor, Professor PJ Narayanan and Parikshit. The goal of our work is the analytic computation of radiance due to area light sources, which is typically very hard to handle, and ray tracing is the go-to method for it. But at low sample counts, ray tracing has a lot of noise. And hence, we aim to have a completely analytic solution, which is also noise-free in the shadow regions, and particularly soft shadow regions. So let's look at the problem from the perspective of the rendering equation. And for that, we'll consider a single scene. In this scene, we have one light source and one object apart from the ground plane. And we look at the how to shade this point marked in red. And for that, we draw the unit sphere around this point and shade it with the BRDF response. Now the rendering equation will give you the radiance due to that light source by integrating over the upper hemisphere of the BRDF times the incoming light times the cosine foreshortening factor. Typically this equation is estimated using Monte Carlo techniques for n samples. And if you have low samples, you will get a lot of variance and hence noise. And formally, we would like to compute this integral analytically with an approximation known as the linearly transformed cosines, or LTCs. Before moving on to how we use LTCs for computing that integral, we'll look at the definition of LTCs. So we rewrite the rendering equation like so. The only difference from the previous rendering equation is that the factor Li has been taken outside the integral, since we assume that the light is spatially constant. And the integration domain is now the spherical polygon P, which is the projection of the light source on the unit sphere. LTCs give us a way of approximating this integral analytically by first linearly transforming the BRDF to a clamped cosine BRDF, and also similarly transforming the polygon P to a new polygon P naught. And if you look closely, this new integral is just the irradiance due to a spherical polygon, which can be computed analytically using a well-known formula. A crucial thing to note is that the term Li has an implicit dependence on the visibility V, which is not taken into account. And hence, LTCs produce a result like so, which does not have any shadows. And the main reason for that is that we always integrate over the entire light spherical polygon, and irrespective of whether it's occluded by any other object. So an interesting thing you could do to incorporate occlusions is to perform shadow ray tracing and combine this stochastic method with analytic LTC method, which is exactly what was done by Heitz and colleagues in 2018, using a ratio estimator formulation, which did shadow ray tracing and denoised only the shadow part and combined it with the analytic LTC integration. Now, the thing again to note here is that the shadow ray computation is stochastic. The shadow computation is stochastic and hence prone to noise and variance, which is expected to be handled by the denoiser. And we actually aim to have the shadow computation also as an analytic formula. So now we come to our solution, which is if you go back to the previous setup of a light source projected onto the unit sphere for the one shading point, we also note that you can similarly project the occluder onto the same unit sphere. And now if we can somehow apply LTC and integrate only over the difference polygon, which basically denotes the portion of the light that's visible, we will naturally obtain soft shadows, good soft shadows. So simplify this problem a bit and look at one triangle at a time, one of the light source and one of the occluder. In this case, the sequence of operations can be defined like so. First, we project both of these to the unit sphere, obtaining spherical triangles. Next is that we clip them to the horizon. This clipping to the horizon operation is actually very important because that ensures correctness of LTC integration. The next is that we apply the set difference operation on the light triangle and the occluded triangle, giving us a visible only polygon of the light source. And then we apply LTC and integrate over only this polygon. This process has to be repeated for all occluded triangles, given one light source triangle, and the result can be, in the end, can be summed up. This already produces very good soft shadows and that noise-free soft shadows. Some points to note here are that the clip to horizon function that we've proposed in the paper is a general clip to horizon function. What that means is that it not only works for spherical triangles, but it also works for n-sided spherical polygons. This is important because this allows us to work with meshes which are not triangulated. And also it is important for an optimization which we'll soon talk about. The next is that the set difference operation between two spherical polygons is non-trivial to compute directly on the unit sphere. So we project all these polygons to a 2D plane and compute the set difference operation there and reproject back to the unit sphere. And in the implementation, we have used the Greener-Horman clipping algorithm for computing the set difference, but any algorithm that you find suitable could also be used. And finally, we also apply a frustum culling strategy between the frustum is from the shading point to the light source. And this allows us to just prune away occluded triangles that won't affect your shading anyway. And for example, this also allows us to, this whole strategy, per triangle strategy, allows us to replace the light source with a much complex light source like a icosahedron here. At this point, we ask ourselves, can we optimize this even further? Going back to our initial setup, we notice that all we care about is the difference area or the visible area, right? We don't care about whether the area is made from difference of two triangles or two polygons. We just care about these difference area. And then can we obtain this directly? if we assume that the occluder and the light source meshes are convex, then we can use its silhouette edges as viewed from the shading point and project them onto the unit sphere, and then apply the same sequence of operations like we saw earlier. So this means that we have two projection operations, one for the light source spherical polygon obtained from silhouette edges and one for the similarly for the occluder. We are then the clipping in the middle and set difference in the right. So this roughly reduces the polygon operations from n squared for the per triangle approach to only two polygon operations. And in the paper, we've shown that this results in a speed up of more than 2x, two times from the per triangle approach. Now, and a crucial thing also to note is that silhouette edges cannot directly work for non-convex meshes because non-convex meshes have ridges which produce incorrect, which do not strictly give you boundary polygons. So that results in wrong shading. Let's look at some results for some complex scenes other than just a single light source. And this particular scene is actually very interesting. In the left, you have a circular light source, and just above, on top of it, you have a smaller circular occluder. And our method is directly able to handle it without without any noise. Whereas the ratio estimator method is actually very good at the unoccluded parts, but at the occlusion, it's noisy because it's still stochastic. And the direct illumination ray tracing, as expected, is noisy. Also, I forgot to mention is that all of these methods are run for roughly equal times. In this case, it's 24 seconds. Even the quantitative metrics also show that our method performs better than even the ratio estimator method. Here is another result. Again, this scene is run for all the methods on the scene are run for roughly 17.5 seconds. And this is the result that we get. Our method obtains, again, the lowest quantitative metrics. We also look at another scene. This is the living room scene from our paper. And this result is for direct illumination ray tracing for an equal amount of time as this ratio estimator, which is, again, noise-free, very good at unoccluded regions, but noisy at the shadow regions. And finally, here's our method, which is completely noise-free everywhere. We now come to some limitations and future directions of our work. First is that can LTCs themselves be made better? Since LTCs are actually they're an approximation to the actual BRDF. And that means that our results are always slightly off from the ground truth ray-traced results. The next is, can this be efficiently implemented on GPU? This is very exciting, actually. We'll talk about this in a few seconds. The next is, the final thing is actually robustness, which means that how can we make this method robust for even things like vertices being at the same location or other geometric degeneracies that result from polygon operations? And especially the set difference that we compute has to be extremely robust or you get wrong shading and very discontinuous regions and that don't look very good. So two of these directly lead to future directions, so instead of linear transformations like LTCs, can we have nonlinear transforms? And can we represent even more complex BRDFs, maybe anisotropic BRDFs or something like those? And The most exciting thing for me is GPU implementation because LTCs are already real-time, ratio estimators is already real-time. But if our approach is also real-time, then that means that it has huge potential implications for the gaming industry probably because everything is analytic and the ray budget can be then used for things like global elimination. Finally, I would like to conclude. Before I conclude, I would like to mention the concurrent work of Zhao and colleagues in soon to appear in TOG 2021. They have a similar method to our per triangle approach for analytic visibility computation. And they also demonstrate soft shadows. But the main thing there is that they have a robust implementation with a few tricks that they have proposed in their paper, which also account for geometric degeneracies like the vertices being at the same location, et cetera, that I mentioned. another good thing is that they have an hybrid approach, which has alias-free renderings, which is again very important for if you want to apply it to games or even movies. And the big thing there is analytic gradients for use with differentiable rendering. Analytic gradients actually allow you for have a lot of applications, which I think it's very good what they have. Okay, so I'd like to conclude by just showing you the scene which was generated by our method using the silhouette edge approach. And the code is available at the link given here, implemented on top of PBRT version 3. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Impressive. It kind of reminds me of our work by George Litakis and others quite a while ago. Even though it's quite different, but going in the somewhat in the similar direction. We have one question here at the end. LTC compute a sum over edges. Do you think you could cut corners by only figuring out edges at the set difference polygon in any order rather than computing the full polygon? By Christoph Peters.
Well, I don't understand your question fully, actually.
Maybe Christoph, if you want to clarify this, feel free to do so. You're still muted.
Okay, now you should be able to
hear me. Yes, we see and hear you.
So if you compute the projected solid angle of a polygon, what you get in the end is contour integral. So you only have a summation over every single edge of the polygon. So it doesn't really matter which order you do this sum in. Right. All you need is that you get out the edges and you can do all kinds of crazy tricks. Like if you have edges twice, but in reverse order, they cancel out. So maybe there are some tricks there that you could use to cut corners to somehow make the set difference computation less expensive. Do you have any ideas about that?
Well, actually, in the paper, we have this ordering and closing the loop of the polygons. And that's essentially to ensure that the clip to horizon, etc., are performed properly. But yeah, that's interesting, actually, what you mentioned, that you can maybe not integrate over the same edge because they cancel out. And yeah, I haven't thought about that much. But yeah, I think.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much. I wasn't sure I got the full performance implication of your project. The nice thing about ray tracing is it's essentially independent of scene complexity or weakly dependent on scene complexity, which kind of doesn't really work for, which is different in your application because you have to go through the individual triangles and so on. So can you talk about that a little bit more? And
do you see certainly. I won't say it's very similar to ray tracing, but the frustum thing that you build basically prunes out all other non-important triangles. So in that sense, it's similar to saying that you'd shoot one ray and go through, traverse the BVH. But yeah, it's definitely worse than that. But if you're asking for real-time implementations, I think that certainly has to be something that does not work at the triangle level, but at the more general area level of the unit sphere rather than projecting triangles and working on those.
Yes, I mean, specifically if like the intervening, if the occluding geometry is really complex, right? I mean,
that would
polygons, that wouldn't really work well, right? Have you thought about, I mean, there's all these ideas that people have come up with earlier is just have hierarchical description or proxies for occluders and, but
still not difficult, I mean, right? Probably thinking,
Good. Any other question? That does not seem to be the case, and we're perfectly in time. So please, a big round of applause Akash for his presentation and discussion, but also let's give a great big round of applause for the entire set of presenters and also the questions that very good questions that have been asked. So yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I think we can do better in terms of applause.
But I like this feature a lot. So.
Yeah, it gives a little bit of interactivity here, at least. There's one more announcement that I should make there. There is a town hall starting at 6:30, so in 8 minutes, roughly. This is in a separate room. If you stay here, you will be automatically, I understand, you will be automatically moved into that other room. So there's nothing specific that you have to do. I hope that is correct, Gurpreet. If not, then please correct me. It would be great. It seems to be correct. It would be great to get as many people for this town hall. This is just, in particular, since we're not live here and we're not in person, it's a great way to get feedback from everyone about how this works this year and how maybe we can improve things for next year and just generally discuss EGSR going forward. So all of your input is greatly welcome. So please stay around and we'll start at 6:30 here European time. Thank you very much. And this concludes this session. See you in the town hall.